Yes, we're live now. So, guys.
Oh, yay! Yay!
All three of us, I love
Yeah.
Yeah.
So let's start off just easy stuff. I know I have like a topic today, but meh, like I'm just I just feel like talking to some people because I haven't actually been in a group hangout in a few weeks now, probably. I've been doing more like one-on-ones and stuff. So but anyways, like how have you guys been doing in terms of mental health? I'll start with you, Anya, if you don't mind.
Oh, I've been doing quite well. I mean, with I think with my depression and stuff, I think it's been good. I don't remember myself having depression the last time, actually. And well, with my anxiety, I think it's not that well. I think it's been always kind of the same way, I would say. It's not like ups and downs or anything like that. It's kind of always like, well, the same, you know, kind of the same.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like anxious, and then there are times when I feel a little bit more anxious, let's say. But just in general, I mean, yeah, nothing really special, really. But I think I found it a little bit hard to come back since I was in the US, and
Yeah.
I had like my vacation, and it was a little bit hard to just come back into like this a little bit more stressful, let's say, environment. So I had like that moment of you know, kind of adapting a little bit. So I probably
Yeah.
had like my down moment. I would not necessarily call it like depression and stuff, but you know, a little bit, I felt a little bit down for a while. But thanks to let's say making videos and stuff, I mean, I'm able to express myself, so I'm kind of and getting all the support is kind of awesome.
Yeah, just making a video and kind of venting your feelings and getting feedback from people can be a good form of therapy, I think.
Yeah,
I
absolutely.
agree.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And so what about you, Stephen? How's your mental health been?
actually, the last 3 months have been really poor. We've been rapid cycling and kind of a depressive state, just kind of going up and down from moderately depressed to bad thought depressed. And I have a psychiatrist who is not much into pharmacology, and I've been battling with her for the last 3 months on getting some med changes made. And my personality is to kind of banter around it and not be direct. And I finally went in last month and just was very direct and said, "Look, we have got to make a med change. I can't break this cycle." And she finally acquiesced and made a change in my antidepressants. And about 3 weeks ago, I really started feeling better. And this past week has been really good. I've got no depression at all, and feeling really stable.
Good.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, and so if you don't mind me asking, what kind of med change did you do, just for the viewers that might be interested?
Sure. I use Effexor for my antidepressant, and we upped that to 300 milligrams a day.
Okay. Okay, so you just increased the dosage of the same medication then.
Yes.
Okay, cool. Anya, are you on medication yourself? Oh, be right back.
I'll
I
be back.
was like, what medication is that? I'm like, that's an interesting acronym.
Yeah.
Benzo what? No, I'm kidding. But but
Yeah.
that's cool. So that's been helping you, just increasing the dosage for now.
It has. I do a lot of meds, but with the antidepressants. And about a year ago, I was also on, oh gosh, what was it? Wellbutrin.
Okay.
And she wanted to try and cut down on the antidepressants because with a bipolar, it's not great to have too much antidepressant. We did that, and then I think that's what kind of precipitated this downward spiral into depression. So she was kind enough to up that, so it's really helped, which is a good thing because she's on maternity leave now until October, so I'm glad we got that fixed.
That's honestly so weird, because I've been speaking to so many people where their psychologists have gone on maternity leave, and that's kind of when they end their sessions. Like, it's been a kind of common trend I've noticed. The same thing happened with my psychologist I was seeing a while ago. I saw her for a year, and then she said, I'm going on maternity leave. Do you want me to refer you to someone else? And I was like, well, I guess I can use my coping strategies now, and then I haven't seen one since, so, you know.
Yeah, that's kind of how I've been.
That's interesting. And has it been working for you just in terms of trying to do your own thing, take care of yourself, have your own coping mechanisms as well?
It has. I haven't really had any problems with the mania or depression. So, you know, my mood has been pretty stable this past month. So, hopefully we'll make it to October.
Yeah, and do you notice with changes in the seasons, does that alter your moods and throw things out of whack a little bit too?
It does. Here in Missouri, I mean, we have had rain for the last 4 months.
Oh my God.
It's cloudy, dreary weather, and it does have an effect, with no doubt.
Yeah, I noticed that too, because for myself, I deal mainly with depression and anxiety, so I don't have the bipolar component to me. I mean, I believe everyone has a little bit of something, you know, we're all on some spectrum, you know, so I feel like I get very depressive during the winter months, and that's when I take St. John's wort and I take vitamin D, because I'm in Canada, so we don't get a lot of sunlight. There's like, you know, just eternal winter, basically. So it's like, and then all of a sudden when you hit spring, it's just this influx of like, oh my God, sunlight. And then I get almost manic sometimes. And I wouldn't consider myself to be bipolar, but I definitely have those manic tendencies. And then you feel so good, you just don't know what to do sometimes, because you're like, oh, sunlight and like no more winter. And it's very different, you know, mindset. So.
Yeah, I am for some reason exactly the opposite. My up period is in winter. And my down period is in the summer, but I don't like heat.
Yeah.
You know, so I stay more in the house in the air conditioning, and I get out and about when it's cold. I just feel better.
That's interesting. Well, like, it just shows how different everyone is, and there's not like one medication or one technique for everyone. So.
Yeah.
You know, Lisa, actually what happens actually to me, I would say, because since winters are very long here, it's kind of you get used to it a little bit, and you get used to this weather, and you kind of used to being inside, like in your house, and you're in your comfort zone, let's say, and there are not so many people outside. But then when summer comes, it's kind of so many people get outside, and you also kind of get outside. It kind of just looks a little bit like out of your comfort zone, let's say. I mean, it's just, especially in the beginning. I mean, it gets better, but that's just how it is with me a little bit.
It is. There's so much activity that goes on in the summer, and that just really drives my social anxiety up crazy.
Yeah, definitely. I can understand that.
Yeah, it's weird because I find my anxiety has been kind of transformative lately almost, because like I do get a lot of anxiety too when it's like everyone's out and about, and like because I've been going to this like open farmers market every week now, and there's like stands and people and buy this and I'm like, you know, but I feel like I pass on certain thresholds sometimes where I almost want to be more social. It's like humans adapt so easily. So it's like I've been seeing more friends lately. I've been going out more. I've been doing more things. And I've been thinking stuff like, when can I invite people over to the apartment, and things that I don't usually think, you know? So, I mean, you can adapt to just the change in activity sometimes too.
Yeah, definitely.
It's really interesting.
I agree with this. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, yeah. But,
how's the market going?
Well, the stock market is going. No, I'm kidding. But the farmer's market's actually a lot of fun. And I feel, you see, it's all plays in, because like, I go to the farmer's market, of course, to get lots of like healthy produce and things like that. So I've been eating more like that. And I find the better you eat, the less depressive I feel. And I get, like, I've just been feeling very manic lately, I guess, but not like a manic, like a scary kind of manic, but like a productive, like, I can do anything kind of manic, you know, so.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's been really weird. I've been seeing people consulting about, you know, what to do next in terms of career options and, like, getting out and, like, really making effort to get big things done. And I think it's also the fact that, like, I don't think Steven's aware of this, but I was living with my fiance and his family for a while. We were trying to save money, and I was living with people that weren't eating the way that I'm used to eating, and like a lot of heavy foods, and it was making me more depressive. And like now I'm kind of cooking my own things, and I have a lot more freedom, and I'm feeling more like in control and happier in that way. So that's been changing a lot of other things in my life. So that's been really good.
Oh, that's cool. That sounds awesome.
Yeah, so I've been kind of trying to settle in, and then from here, getting back into Introvert Island. It's so funny because people are like, I'm going on strike, where's Introvert Island? I want to do hangouts. I'm like, I'm sorry, guys, like, I'm busy.
Yeah, you need to live your own life, right, at the end of the day. But you've been making, like, many videos, like, kind of updating and stuff, so that's good.
But it's been very sporadic, so I'm trying now to get back into a schedule, because I find, like, somebody wrote to me, they said something like, Lisa, slow down with the videos, I don't have time to make, like, sarcastic comments. I'm like, okay, sorry, I don't have enough time to think of sarcastic comments to render your videos. I'm like, yeah, you're right. So I think I'm going to go back to doing Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and I find, like, it's good to do raw vlogs and stuff, but I mean, when you guys make videos, do you put a lot of thought and structure into what you're going to say? Because I feel like, Anya, you really do, like, try and create something out of your videos. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, I like to edit, and I like to just work on a video. I mean, but I don't have, like, scripts or anything like that, so I just talk. But, then I like to edit. I mean, this is just, like, kind of a hobby of mine.
I feel like you do put the effort into it. Like, you know, your loneliness video was very good. Immortal actually, you know, linked me in that, so I watched it. I feel like I need people to baby me sometimes. They like link me in a video, like, Lisa, watch this video, and then I'll watch it. But usually it's like my subscription box is like, I get so overwhelmed. So I've been unsubscribing from some bigger YouTubers lately just because, I don't know, it's been driving up my anxiety just to see so many videos, and sometimes I feel almost, like, compulsive, like I need to watch all the videos in my subscription box, and I'm like, wow, I don't have, like, 10 hours a day to just watch all these videos.
Yeah, same problem.
You also have to see what things coincide with your beliefs and what don't. Like, I was watching Stefan Molyneux for a while, and I actually unsubscribed for him because I just wasn't feeling it anymore. So he's like kind of like philosophical, but he's controversial, and I didn't enjoy it anymore. So, you know, sometimes even over a course of a couple of months, you're going to lose interest in some of the content you've been watching. So it's good to kind of like clean it up and follow what actually motivates you and interests you, right? So.
Oh, that's right. That's right. But I actually, like, I've been watching some, like, channels for years now. I mean, that would be, like, some makeup gurus, whatever. I'm sorry, guys, to confess that, but...
Well, maybe Steven enjoys them, too, right? I mean, Gigi Gorgeous, right? Gigi Gorgeous.
There is one person I watch, Emily Sintrest.
Yeah, she's amazing.
And she is amazing, and I've watched her for a couple of years, and I actually got interested in her from the psoriasis videos that she was making with her scalp psoriasis.
Yes.
And I have a daughter who's going through that process right now, so I kind of hooked her up with some of her old videos to kind of catch up on.
That's awesome. Do you follow her too, Anya? Do you know about Emily's interests?
Well, I know, but I mean, I kind of couldn't really relate. I didn't subscribe. I don't know. Sometimes you just feel like, okay. But yeah, I recently subscribed, like, to some more of, like, mental health channels, I would say, in order to support.
Yeah.
Because I think it's awesome to support, you know. I think, for example, Jamal, he's been, like, very nice. I mean, he was making also those mental health hangouts.
Yeah.
Remember that? That was, like, that all started fun, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he also has, like, some deep thoughts and stuff. I mean...
And
he's
the vlogger sagas too, which I love.
Oh, really? That's like so awesome. I mean, I love those. Like, he's so creative, right?
Yeah, I know, and I really like that too. Just supporting people in the community. Also, just to give a shout out to, I'm not sure which channel he's doing it under, but you guys know Lewis in the mental health community. I think his channel is M Sane. I'm going to write in the chat box here. And he's doing hangouts now too. And also Dale, the Dale channel, he's doing hangouts too. And I love being able to know that there's so many hangout options. So let's say you're having a day where you feel like you just can't relate to anyone around you. I mean, when you deal with mental illness, it's like the people in your daily life, you can't relate to everyone. So sometimes you need just a place to go and talk to people that know what depression feels like and stuff. And I just love that I have so many people in my subscription box that are doing live hangouts that I can go and join one if I don't feel like having the energy to host one myself. So there's so many options, and I know Joe Kidwell used to like be the champion of these things, but he kind of slowed down on those too. But there's so many hangouts you can join now, so it's really a beautiful thing, I think.
Yeah, I agree.
Oh, I don't really know, because Joe, I don't know, like, is he having like those still, like those hangouts or whatever? I mean, I never get like anything from him. I mean, how am I supposed to know like he's having hangout, or he's just doing it like, I don't know, he sends messages to those people he wants to talk with, or how does it work?
Well, actually, for him, it's more that he used to do them a lot, and now he doesn't so much. That's okay. Kind of what happened. Because I feel like a lot of people, especially dealing with mental illness, like, it's funny because you see even these trends and how people do their videos. They'll do, like, live hangouts, and they'll be introverted, and they'll get so, like, burnt out from them that they'll just want to do one-on-ones with people. So I went through that phase for a while where I'm like, I don't feel like being an entertainer and hosting something. I want to talk to, like, one person and not feel any pressure. But now that I'm like feeling more established here, I'm feeling like I want to talk to people and see how they're doing and like, you know, get to know how people are feeling these days. And so I think he's been in a phases where sometimes he wants to talk in groups and sometimes he wants to isolate, which I think we can all relate to here. So
yes, we can.
Yes.
I think I was never in a group with him. I mean, I was just like with Hugh Laurie and him. I think we were on a hangout, but it was like long ago, and I never really saw Joe in like in a hangout, but yeah. I think I just came late. I mean, I joined this community late because he was popular back then. Okay, sorry, Joe.
That's so funny. Would either of you guys think of hosting your own hangouts? Like, would that be something you guys would be down for one day?
Guys, I'm just having trouble getting the video up. You know, you turn the camera on and it's just blank. And I usually do try and outline my videos, you know, on paper, so I've got some talking points and stuff like that. But this last few months, it's just been a real struggle to get anything up.
Yeah, no, I completely get that. Sometimes, like, and I don't think any content producer should feel pressure. Like, if people are saying, like, where's your videos? Or if you feel like I should be uploading, like, tune into yourself. And if you're just feeling like you need time to isolate, that should be something that's embraced in the mental health community. And if someone comes back after a few months and says, hey, I'm still here, they should be embraced and not, like, no one should get mad at them for not producing content. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do.
So, it's normal.
Yeah. But I was like suggested like to start those too. I mean, by Jamie, my friend Jamie. So I don't really know. I don't know. Sorry. Am I talking weird? I don't really know how to do this stuff. I mean, like really now I just kind of need to learn this. But also I feel a little bit like, you know, I'm just afraid that somebody would take control over me. You know,
like with the hangouts, or
with the hangouts. It's like it's very dangerous, right? I mean, you're just hosting your own hangouts, and then all of a sudden, some people come, and like it all just turns out to be a mess. I mean,
yeah,
I don't know. It just sounds really disappointing to me.
Anya, I've never experienced that before, so I have no idea what you're talking about.
I know, like, seriously, Lisa. I mean,
there's never been any drama on my channel.
Oh,
like,
no.
No, not at all.
You know, I mean, just normal YouTube channel where I don't get, you know, like, massive dislikes on, like, in a row on my videos or anything.
Yeah, well, so, you have only likes, Lisa, really. Yeah. You just get so much love. You're just swimming in love.
Swimming in love. Like, to be real, sometimes I'll see the comments or I'll see the dislikes, and it will really discourage me. And then every time you have to go back and realize what your virtues are, what matters to you. And honestly, what's been encouraging me, which I'd encourage you guys to do if you're not already, is sometimes do a one-on-one hangout with someone in the community that really inspires you, and it can get you back on your feet again. You know what I mean? It can help you just feel good about your channel and about your life and about just what you're trying to do on here. So
that's a good idea.
Yeah, I've been doing that. Like, Joe Kidwell and I have been friends on here for over a year, so we'll do hangouts sometimes. And also, if you guys know Zinnick in the community too, he's very helpful. So
yeah,
we've been doing hangouts and just kind of catching up and bouncing ideas off of each other and talking about, like, philosophy and science. And, like, it's been very encouraging for me, so I'd recommend that for you guys too.
Okay.
Yeah, that's awesome. Well, I used to talk, like, to some people as well. it just changes at times. It just, like, people change. I mean, at some point you just talk to one person, and then another time you just talk to another person. I mean, I don't know.
It's true, and it depends who's available and how everyone's mood is. Like, in the mental health community, I hate to say it, but there's no reliability, because sometimes you'll be, like, wanting to talk to someone, they're like, sorry, I'm depressed right now, I'll talk to you later. And it's like, you know, it's harder to.
Oh, really? Did you have that? I never had that, really. I just, like, you know, oh, I'm so depressed, I need to talk about this. You know, I mean, I got it, many times. I mean, I didn't get, like, depressed people who would say, oh no, like, I'm so depressed, like, go away.
I've had that before. They're just like, really? I'm not in a good mood, can we do this another time? I'm like, okay. So, you
seriously?
Know, it happens.
Oh,
yeah.
My God.
And sometimes I'm like, are you sure? And sometimes they agree, and then they feel better when they talk about it. Because, you know, sometimes just going in a hangout like this, even if you're in a terrible mood when you start, you can end, like, the conversation and feel great after, you know? So.
Oh, yeah, that happens. Or the other side, the opposite. Like, sometimes it just turns to be like a disaster, and you think, okay, well, I shouldn't have started, like, really.
But the whole point is, you never know, right? So you gotta just see what
that's
happens.
Right.
And
yeah, you just gotta put it out there.
Yeah, because I know poor Steven, when you came into the hangout and you were in a good mood and you went to chat with people, then it went, like, all, like, into different topics, and you're like, I'm out of here. And I was like, oh, because I really want my channel, as much as I go into, like, science and I go into nutrition and I go into different things, I really want the focus to be mental health, because that's the thing that, you know, I find a lot of my subscribers can relate to, and that's where I want this channel to go, not arguing about females versus males and this. I mean, that stuff's interesting, but I think my channel, my space, I really want this to be about mainly mental health, unless I do make a specific hangout where I'm like, anything goes, or this is about something other than mental health, then fine.
Right.
But this today, I want it to, Introvert Island should be mental health time, I think. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, nutrition and stuff, they're kind of connected with mental health, right? So.
True. Very true.
Very true.
Yeah.
But I think that Steven, see, he sounds to me like he could be friends with the dog, Hugs. No? Could he be friends with him?
Like,
do they know each other? Do you know him?
No, I don't.
Oh, wait, we are kind of, we don't have, like, he's not here today. I don't know. Where is he, Lisa? Do you know?
I'll try and invite him. I know he's been trying to be more productive lately and get stuff done, but we'll see what,
He's not in a good mood or something.
No, he might just be busy, but I'll try and,
I mean, for some reason, I don't know, just Steven reminded me about dog hugs. It's like, I don't know why.
I'll invite a few people. I'll invite Joe, and I'll invite Lewis. And here's Hugh Laurie. Hi, Hugh.
Okay. That sounds weird.
That was hilarious. Is that you, Hugh?
Oh, my God. I didn't hear him for, like, forever.
Really?
Yeah.
Is he even here, though, is the question, or are you one of those robot things?
No, I don't really get, like, the most of my, like, I don't know, friends, I think it's him. I don't really know where he is and where he's not. I mean, it's, like, it's so confusing already. Like, I'm just, like, I don't really know. But I only know Hugh. I mean, I don't really know others, but there are so many, right, Lisa?
Yeah, there's a lot of different accounts. Oh, and of course, there's a lot of different accounts of me, and there's a lot of different, you know, accounts of a lot of people in here, so it gets confusing sometimes, but that's okay. Nothing wrong with having alters.
Nope, that's right.
Oh, Doug just said he got here 5 minutes ago. Yes, you can join, Doug. Please do. And look, we also have Lewis, Speak of the Devil. Hi, Lewis. Oh, Lewis, if you're here, do you want to talk about your hangouts you do every week? Because that would be cool to kind of enlighten us.
Yeah, am I coming through?
Yes.
Yeah, right. Well, I've not actually done any really properly. I've tried to, but I think I might have invited you guys like 45 times or something the other time.
You did. Yeah. I was like, what are all these notifications from yesterday?
Yeah. I'm just trying to learn the technical stuff. Like, maybe you could tell me. Like, I think if you start an event, that might help. You know, like, I don't know the technical stuff. I get lost in all the menus and everything, but
I know. I can help you sometime, but it depends. Like, you can start it through Google Plus, and then you'll have the live, you know, the Q&A tab that you can ask questions.
Yeah.
Or you can start it through YouTube, and then you'll have the live chat feature, which I'm obsessed with, because you can go check there, and people are, you know, chatting over there, and that's fun too. So you can do it.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't think I'd keep up with that. I'd probably spaz out, honestly. But Yeah. I'm just on the basics. I'm not quite at that stage. I just want to, like, I'll probably just feel my way through the menus, like, on my own and work it out sometime. But,
cool.
It's weird. I started one, and then, like, I tried to start another one, and, like, I couldn't even, like, start it on air.
Really? So,
and that was really confusing. I couldn't find how to start it on air. It was as if the option wasn't there. It's just, like, that was proper confusing, but
Yeah,
I just need the time. But yeah, anyway, fucking, it's going to be Sundays, 6 o'clock. It's going to be like replacing Joe's one, in effect, I guess, because Sunday was just a good time for me. So, yeah. But no one turned up to the last one, I don't think. I don't think anyone turned up, understandably, because the first one was a flop.
And, really?
Yeah. Aww. Well, no, it was a flop. No, it was a flop because I didn't know how to let people join.
Okay.
It was technical flop again, but anyway, I'm gonna eat my food. I just got back from work and stuff like that, so I need to fucking eat something. So you
all
guys
right.
Talk.
Cool. Yeah. Well, hi Doug, welcome.
Hi, can you guys hear me? Did I set everything up okay?
Yep.
Sounds great.
Yeah. Hi Doug.
I'm on lunch. I have my bowl of blueberries. Raspberries, and what are these things, if you can see them?
Blackberry?
Is that a blackberry?
Yes.
Yep.
No, is it?
Well, there's a blueberry, and then the
black thing beside it.
Right. Is that a blackberry?
Yeah.
Hashtag nutrition. It's like, wow.
So, all I can say is that I do not like the taste. I love the blueberry, but
Jamal.
I do not like the blackberry. I think it's giving me, like, intestinal pain or something.
What? Oh, dude, don't eat them then.
Well, I bought them, so I have to eat them.
No. I've thrown out things that have given me allergies because I don't want to die. I'm like, life versus money.
I cannot eat berries. Like, I would just rather make like a smoothie or something. That's so much easier, right? I mean,
yeah.
I cannot just eat, like, sit and eat berries. I mean, I don't really like them. Oh, what's that, Lisa?
A beautiful apple.
Oh, really? It looks like an apple from this, how is it called? The girl who ate an apple and actually she fell asleep. How is that?
Sleeping Beauty or something?
Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
Oh,
yeah. I'm like Sleeping Beauty. I'm so bad. See, you guys, I don't believe in fairy tale love. Proven.
Well, no. We now believe. We can see. Okay, hope nothing will happen. Please be careful.
We'll see, we'll see. Remember, Doug, the whole the banana thing? Like, if you eat it in the dark, it makes melatonin and you get sleepy? That's pretty cool.
I do not have any bananas, and I know between the coffee and the bananas, when you mix those two, it just knocks me out. I don't know why.
With coffee?
Oh, God.
Coffee plus seriously. Bananas, and I don't know why. It just knocks me right out.
Oh, that's nice. You don't need to like take like any sleeping pills. You can just.
Yeah, just a coffee and a banana and for about 20 minutes I get a really good sleep, but then I'm all hyped up from the coffee. So
yeah.
It's like, oh, I only need 20 minutes sleep and I can be productive.
Yeah, it's pretty...
That's okay. If you fall asleep, Lisa, your hubby will come home and wake you up with a kiss.
No, we would call Expelladoc and he would... he would kiss her. I know. He would wake her up.
Oh, no. Yeah, X-Pal, I haven't heard from him in a while, actually. Well, a couple weeks ago, I think. He's been, like, commenting on some videos. That's been good.
Yeah, actually, I've seen a couple of videos which we both comment, and I see him, and I see his comment, and I'm thinking, do I comment or do I not comment? I'd hate to think that there's going to be, like, some kind of... negativity that happens because you both comment on the same video. Is that way too crazy of me?
Like what? Videos like what?
Some MGTOW videos that... I'm trying to think of the name. I can't
Doug,
think of...
how dare you bring up MGTOW in here? I'm going to use my Emerald Hammer of Justice on you.
I brought.
I'm sorry, Lisa.
Sorry.
I'm sorry. I say thug.
In video. Is that way too crazy of me?
Okay, like, I hear some feedback here.
Yeah, me too.
Some MGTOW videos.
I'm going to have to mute you. Sorry, Zara. I had to mute you because you need headphones.
Jamal, are you here?
Mr. Williams.
Before you go on, is that crazy that I would not post on a video that I see that he posted on the same video?
I think it's understandable, you know, if you're posting on somebody else's page and, you know, you don't want to start a flame war going on somebody else's page. And I've had that same thought on when I was posting on some pages, too.
But did you end up posting or did you not post because of it?
I did not, just because I didn't want to start a flame war on somebody else's channel.
But at the same time, I don't want to have my post, like my ability to post on a third party's channel to be curtailed, to be like, oh, I can't do anything because he's here.
Well, I agree. I think it's a double-edged sword, and, you know, you just have to, I guess, you know, see where you want to comment. And if you do comment and a flame war results, then, you know, maybe just curtail it after that. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's hard.
Well, as long as I don't respond directly to him, I think I'm okay. As long as I respond directly to the video itself, I should be okay.
Yeah, I think you'd be okay.
Yeah, you would. You definitely would. You don't need to worry about this, Doug.
No, it's not a super worry. It's just a little worry. I have a story if anyone... Oh, actually, I interrupted someone else. Please, go on.
I'm open for a story.
Okay, I was at... I went down and grabbed my coffee at the local convenience store. It's a 7-Eleven. And this really hot girl, who was about... looked like about my age, so she was older, but still hot, which is, you know, a contradiction in terms. She bought a Diet Coke and gummy bears. Doesn't that defeat the purpose? And I was going to say, I wanted to say something. I wanted to introduce myself, but that video of the girl who walked around for 10 hours, kept on getting, like, saying hi is a catcall, made me stop. I was like, I would really like to say hi to this girl, but is that being offensive? Would that be invading her personal space?
Why can't we just all agree as a society? Like, there's certain places where you can do it and certain places where you can't. So, like, there should be,
is that a like, place where you can't?
A convenience store? I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's just, well, like, it's so dumb about it. Because, I mean, some people probably wouldn't mind, but then others would. It's just so dumb. We need to just have, like, specified places. Bars, obviously you can, you know, like, but, like, any nightlife kind of area where people are obviously there to meet people. You can, but I don't know, convenience stores, grocery stores, stuff like that. I feel like that's sort of, some people would be like, I'm just trying to buy my gummy bears and whatever. No, I don't want to be bothered.
That's why I think I made the right decision not to.
Yeah, you might.
I just wish I had the mental fortitude to say hello.
When I go for my morning walks, like when I was going out to the park and stuff, I would say hello to everyone. And there were these two old Chinese guys, Asian guys, I shouldn't say Chinese, and they were so happy to say hi to me back, the big smiles on their face, hi, how you doing, and whatever, right? They made the walks and saying hi really wonderful, but there's this one old lady that I would say hi to exactly the same way, and she would give me the look of death, and I was like, don't do that again. I was like, whoa, geez, all I did was say hi, good morning.
Yeah, Doug, that's why you've got to, like, try and stop worrying about the outcome, like, easy as I make it sound, and just do shit, you know, because some people react one way, some people react the complete other, you know. Some people, fuck, a serial killer might fucking murder you for looking at them and smiling. Someone else might start to, you know, like, parry you or something. That's out of your control, bro.
Yeah, I think not saying hi to the girl in the convenience store was the right idea, or was the right
decision. You can just,
so I didn't. Yay. And saying hi in my morning walks is okay because we're all out. It's like 5, 6 in the morning, and it's okay because we're all there for the same reason, just to enjoy the day, and yeah.
Wait, Doug, like, what portion of, like, friendships and relationships and stuff do you think were formed in, like, I don't know, environments that is not just about socializing, like a bar or a club or something? Like, are they all improper relationships, all those ones that have been formed in random places? Like, it's kind of silly. Like, it's kind of like, I mean, I have these rigid kind of ideas too, like, kind of built into me, like, you know, it's wrong, like you're being overly assertive or something, but it's just not true. It's just bullshit, you know? Like, you can say hi to someone anywhere. Like, it's obviously there's some points, like, that's ridiculous, but, like, a grocery store, really, you can say, well, fuck, you can say no. You're not raping someone, you know?
You can just say hi and then engage her body language, and then, if obviously, I mean, you can tell, like, if she is receptive or not, and then you can have something else to say, I guess.
Yeah, don't just pinch her bum if she smiles at you.
That's not normal.
No, I like what David Westrum said at the start, that some places it is inappropriate to, because I'm just buying gummy bears. I didn't ask to be talked to. I kind of agreed with what he originally said.
Maybe, but if you just said hi, like, that's not anything. That's, you can just do that and then get practice reading their body language to see if they're actually open to talking or not.
That's a weird sound.
It's interesting you say body language. Just the other day, I went out to a grocery store that I don't very often go to called Lucky's Market. And it's kind of a Whole Foods organic place. And I was just amazed by how everybody in there was just smiling and they'd look at you and they'd say hello, all the customers. I mean, it was just a really nice experience, better than most of the grocery stores I go to.
Yeah,
the grocery store I go to, there's not a lot of smiling and stuff, but I do get along with the cashiers. They say hi and we talk a little bit, so. Which is odd. Well, actually, it was odd. I was walking up to the store, and one of the cashiers was right at the bus stop, and we got into a fairly lengthy conversation, which was good. So it was quite odd. Quite irregular.
Wow.
Yeah.
Was it inappropriate though? Because were you not like infecting? Were you not contaminating the sterile and work-based relationship between the staff member and the the consumer?
I worry about that. I mean, they're at a job. They're stuck there. They don't want to be bothered with people saying hi and having a conversation. But I know at the same time you want to be nice to them because they're the people who touch your food. So you want to be respectful and please don't spit in my coffee. That stuff.
They put anything in there, bro. Anything.
Yeah.
Lol.
Yeah. But yeah, no, this is something, right? And I've read about this. People with social anxiety, they tend to have very rigid perceptions of what's socially appropriate. Like, a book told me, some person with a fucking qualification in psychology or something, so I must be right. But it's true, though. Like, I used to, have it very bad when my essay was very severe. Yeah, it's like, most people don't socialize like that. It's not healthy. I don't want to be an arsehole, but this stuff's kind of just bullshit. What are you gonna do? How are you gonna spoil their life? I got so much fucking frustration from being depressed most of my life and stuff. And fuck me, if I can't even fucking say hi to someone, if that's too much, because I feel like fucking beating the shit out of people if they on a regular basis just because of my frustration. you can't even say hi to someone at a risk that it's the wrong place if it's a grocery store or something. Fuck me. That's lame. Can I go on a tangent, right? This guy at work called me Blue Lou today behind my back. That's random, right?
Yeah.
I don't know what that means. Blue, well, my name's Lewis, means depressed and shit. And it's you know, I wanted to do terrible things to him, even though he's actually a nice guy now. But it's just this shit's really feeble and lame. Is a grocery store the right place? It's that's what my family's like, and they've got severe SA. I'm trying to help. I feel like I'm rambling now, but yeah.
Well, I don't think please don't hit me with the Emerald Hammer of Justice, but to relate back to that video, I don't think the feminists who make, it impossible just to say hi to someone is helping society in any way, shape, or form. I'm sorry, Lisa.
No, talk about what you want. Yeah. This is entertaining.
We're not going down this road, are we?
I'm sorry. Well, it makes it really hard when people who are normal, supposedly, make it impossible to have interactions with another person.
Yeah, I know I'm not normal, so it's probably my abnormality that causes me not to say things. So
yeah, why be normal? You guys ever see that poster with the three turtles? Two of them are swimming, and one of them has the shell out and rowboating.
No.
Okay, it was a long time ago.
There's no such thing as normal.
Yeah. Normal is highly overrated.
I just wanted to mention, Weston, I loved your marriage video. I saw the title and I was like, this is gonna be good, so I watched it all and I was like, did you guys see David Weston's video? What was it titled exactly?
I didn't.
I think it was Marriage is Unnecessary and Absurd or something like that.
Yeah, I saw that.
I went to a wedding, so I witnessed firsthand the just ridiculousness.
Does he know you went to his wedding and went home and told like?
I don't know. I don't think he watches my videos. So.
And you were the best man too, so. You know?
I was. I said at the beginning of the video, like, I'm happy for him and everything. And,
you did. You covered yourself.
He seems very happy, so good for him. I think
you
it's
are.
Ridiculous.
I'm happy for them, but they're ridiculous.
You should have,
not
brought
him,
a loudspeaker.
But, like, the whole ceremony.
Yeah. I get it.
It wasn't directed at anyone specifically.
Mm-hmm.
I saw some stats on.
It's funny because my dad's like watching This Is Introvert Island apparently, so I'm like, hi, Dad.
That's weird. Oh.
Say something highly inappropriate.
Spy it on
okay. David.
Nice for you, Lisa.
Okay. Now David needs to tell his story, his personal story that he told to everyone.
No! Yay! Don't scare him off like that.
Watch my video. Watch the video.
Watch my video. Yeah.
You already said it all. Nothing else can be added.
I've got a personal video up.
That's a nice promotion, David. It's like, if you want to know, go watch my video.
Yeah.
And then you gotta link it to your Patreon.
That's right. You could like get money for that, David.
For what?
I'm gonna make David a Patreon trailer, and it's gonna be really good.
Can't wait. I think anybody would actually. No one would actually pay me. No one's gonna pay me at this point.
How many people have bought your book, by the way?
Not many.
What book? I didn't hear about the book. What's with the book?
I wrote a novel.
Oh, really?
Earlier this year, yeah.
About?
And it's kind of like based loosely on my college experiences, but not really. It's like a mystery.
Did you
it's
do
a
all
mystery
that?
Novel.
Damn.
I'll link to it. I'll link
died.
To it.
Oh, okay. So
more promotion. More
more David. You can do it.
Yeah. All employees, like, no one's bought, not, it's like, not many people bought my book, and it's like hundreds and hundreds of people. Please support me. No one's bought it.
No, I'm being real. Not many.
Your whole thing's authenticity, so if you were lying right now, that would be a pretty bad thing.
No.
Hey, David. Like, I'm one of the few people that's read it, and I actually found a way to not pay you for it.
What do you mean?
Yeah. I don't want to say because I don't want you to lose money, but, like, I found a way for a certain online promotion to get around it. So,
Thanks for letting me know.
Yeah. I read it all, and it was good. I'll tell everyone listening, it was a good book. It was actually, like, well-written and quite intriguing and crap like that. So it reminded me a little bit of what's that book? You've read it, David. The one with the thing. But it was good. I can't remember the name, but it was good book to buy it. It's just this book. You've read it, and you said you've read it, and it reminded me of that book with his slightly cynical kind of persuasion. But I just can't.
Catcher in the Rye. I don't know.
It's that one. Yes, that's it. Yeah. Yeah. Did I say nigger? Oops. But yeah.
You just called me nigger, yeah.
Yeah, no offense. No offense. Sorry, Jamal, I'm not racist. Yeah. That was inappropriate. What's your dad thinking right now?
What?
Do you think your dad wants to hear about David's, like, sexual exploits? Because, like, David made a video about it. He's not talking. Like, it's a challenge. What?
He probably doesn't. He probably has zero interest in that. Probably negative interest.
No, but honestly, David, your content's been really cool and very, like, different, and I appreciate that, to be honest. It's, you've made a lot of really interesting videos recently, so every time I see a video, I'm like, oh, what's this? This is cool, so.
That's good, because I was trying to figure, like, I was thinking this week, like, what, I don't know what to make videos about, like, or I don't know if my videos are valuable to anybody, so I'm trying to figure out how to make videos that are actually valuable to people, but I don't know why people enjoy my videos, so I was gonna make a video asking people, why do you watch my videos? Like, what do you get out of it? So I might still do that. Just
some
to do a little.
Some people are gonna pool. Say your beard, by the way.
They might. They and that's fine. And I'll keep that then.
Yeah. Because Alien Zen just said he'll buy your book if you don't shave your beard for 3 months. So.
Nice.
Oh.
Nice.
That's a good deal.
$3. I don't know. I gotta
it's not worth it. It's not worth it, David.
Yeah, I don't know. I gotta keep it trimmed. I don't wanna let it go.
David,
crazy.
You should do an ASMR video on trimming your facial hair. People would watch it. I'd watch that.
Oh yeah.
I'd definitely watch that.
From the closet, Lewis.
Love it.
Oh, what kind of ideas you have, Lisa? Now I know where Steve got those ideas. Mafiosis, where he got those ideas.
My whole subscription box is just ASMR videos.
Seriously. That's why. Oh, now I get it. Now I get why you feel like so anxious when you just come on YouTube and see like all your subscription box and stuff. Like, yeah, I would be anxious too.
Hey, you know what's really embarrassing, right? I found a mothering ASMR video.
Oh.
I'm that much of a desperate loser. I looked up mothering online, I found an ASMR video, and I quite liked it for a few minutes, and I thought, yeah, this is satisfying. So, yeah. If any of you have dead mothers or such and need to be mothered, look up ASMR mothering and be a sad weirdo.
That is sad, Lewis. That's cute.
Yeah,
though.
That's
I know.
Cute.
Yeah,
that is
sad.
Yeah, absolutely.
What does it consist of, though? A mothering video.
It's the actual
like, crying, holding like the laptop like this or something.
It's a real attempt at I can't see, but it's a real attempt at like what it's like to be mothered for a young wounded child.
Yeah.
And I didn't watch it the whole way through, and I didn't watch it for sleeping purposes. I watched it because I'm mother deprived. Anyway,
It must be good. Like, seriousness, though, that's a good idea. I think it sounds like
a fair idea.
All my gangster ass motherfucker friends won't be impressed though if they watch this video. This
They're not watching it.
No, not my gangster friends. Not like my total gangster friends. Anyway, what were you saying, David?
Oh, I've never found like a really good ASMR channel. Like I just can't. Like I'll watch one and try to relax for like 10 minutes, and then it's just I don't know. I can't find someone. Well, I found one video that works, but then like her other videos just aren't. They just don't work for me. So I don't know. I don't know what it is. I guess they don't work on me. I don't get like the chills or whatever people get. I don't actually experience ASMR.
Well, here's a question. Like, how many people here have actually got the chills or had that feeling before from one of those videos?
Silence. Silence. It's the best answer.
Hashtag introvert.
No, everyone's too bored. Everyone's too bored of them if they watch them to even, like, have the patience to get that kind of board. They get the wrong kind of board and click off, you know?
I actually hate mouth noises, so I just get mad. So I actually don't watch them. I'm like, ugh, mouth noises.
Yeah.
You know?
Wait, what the fuck?
Well, you know all the whispering ones, and you hear all the breath and the noise.
All
the
clicks.
The only thing I watch, this is really weird, but do you guys know Graveyard Girl on YouTube? She's like a big YouTuber.
Yeah. I know.
Okay, she does these unboxing videos of these little figurines called Shopkins, And it's just like a close up of her opening these packages, and it's like Pokemon cards, mm-hmm. the same idea. And I get excited. I'm like, what's she gonna get? And it's like 20 minutes long, and I watch the whole video. I'm like, what is she gonna get today? And it like makes all these noises when she's unwrapping them, and I love it. That actually calms my anxiety.
Oh, now we know what you do. Like now we know what you're busy with. Actually,
that's my subscription box. Just like all these unboxing videos. I'm like unboxing time.
Yeah, Lisa, that's actually sadder than what I did, I think. You know, you should only watch it to get to sleep or to be mothered. They're the only two valid reasons.
Damn it, so my reasons are invalid and my opinions are wrong. I knew it.
Yes.
I should make an unboxing video. That's what I'll do. Just for Lisa.
Yeah.
Well, Xbox, what should I order? The MGTOW box, remember?
Oh, yeah.
What's going to be inside?
Is that one of those boxes that are on men's laps, on a man's lap, and it opens up and there's a penis, yeah? Because I'd watch David's video in slow motion if you did that.
Oh, God. I don't know.
Oh, my God. I do only nature box unboxing, and I don't think I do ASMR, so...
Well, before you get that box, Lisa... When you get the box from Expelladoc, you're going to show us, right? You're going to show us.
Okay, I'm still waiting, man. I'm like, dude, I gave you my PayPal. He's like, no, you didn't. I'm like, all right, well.
Whatever.
On a serious note, I did just donate to someone. I actually saw the cause through you, Doug, the guy who's trying to see his son.
Yes. Actually, I'm sorry you did. Thank you, I guess. I'm kind of worried. It was MGTOW United the one that doxed you?
Yes. So, I found it through N Feminism, who I like a lot. I know this is going a little bit gender dynamics. The point is, like, we were talking about donations and things, and I didn't donate a lot. I just donated $5. But, I mean, when you think about it, every little thing counts. If someone's trying to reach a goal, it's just someone that just is not able to, like, they're losing all their money to child support and everything, and they need money to get a car to go and visit their son, basically. It's like a very sad story. So I said, you know what? I'll donate. So
very kind of you. Did you watch the video where he showed his pay stub where it was all wiped out from mm-hmm. child services?
Yeah.
I like because I'm not American, I had trouble reading his pay stub. Did anyone who is an American read it? Sorry, I didn't mean
Yeah, where are you from?
Noises?
Yeah, someone's doorbell is ringing.
They're like,
I'm sorry, that's probably me. I've got a house full of wind-up clocks that my wife collects.
Oh, that would explain the million clocks.
We need a video of it. Make a video of that.
I need to go around and turn them off before I do anything.
I'm in house.
But, have we talked about goal setting yet?
No.
Since that's in the title? No. I'm just curious. Sorry, we can keep talking about clocks or whatever.
Wait, but Doug, you were saying something. So you were just asked where you're from first. Let's go with that.
Okay. Yes. I'm from Canada, Calgary.
Okay.
So I don't understand the FICA and all the different things from the pay stub of an American. So I was looking at that, and I was trying to read it, and I was hoping somebody who is an American could look at it to confirm that he was actually wiped out from child support payments. He actually had to pay, like, his entire paycheck to his ex-wife, for, like, services. Anyone who is familiar with that type of pay stub, if you could take a look at it to confirm it, that'd be great. You know,
can you put the location down in the comments, and I'll.
Okay, I'll look for it.
Is it on your website?
In a couple of minutes. So carry on, guys. I'll go find it.
What are we talking about?
Yeah, you can carry on with a few minutes to put that up.
John,
so carry on with something else. Anything else?
Yeah, stop jerking off.
Oh, I have a thing before I do this. Does anyone have any wedding stories? Because I have a wedding story.
David has plenty, but
this wedding story, my daughter was at a wedding, and they were Christians, and they were fully, my daughter and my son, or this daughter, this girl and my son are going to make it, and they're going to be wonderful parents, and they're going to make it the entire, you know, road to old age, and they were so proud, and 50, this toast was supposedly so filled with arrogance and pride that after 6 months, these two got divorced. And it was a bad divorce. And I personally laughed.
Yeah.
My daughter was it was unbelievable. Well, yeah, I laughed because, I mean, such arrogance that you're going to, you know, be together forever and blah, 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 blah. And you're so absolutely assured because you're Christian and God is bringing these two together and blah, blah, blah. it was just amazing that after 6 months, it totally fell apart. And the guy ended up sleeping on my daughter's couch. So it's like unbelievable. Anyway, so that was a funny story. To me, it was funny. To them, it's sad as hell.
Wedding story. A wedding story.
It was a wedding story.
So the wedding I was just at was like that too. It was mainly like the dad was, so I guess Lisa's dad, since he's watching, can listen to this. But like, okay, the dad like made this two long awkward speeches, like one at the rehearsal dinner and then one at the wedding. And yeah, stuff like that is just like, but there's pressure too. There's like this underlying like threat, like, you know, like he was talking to the groom. If you don't keep this going, like, you know, I'm gonna hurt you. Because there's always that pressure. But he made it like doubly awkward, at least to me. I guess everyone else thought it was normal. Why? If you think that they love each other, like, if you think that they actually love each other, like, why do you need to like make all these, you know, all this pressure? Like, why is all this pressure necessary? Why are all these witnesses necessary? Why do we have to sign? Like, I wasn't even expecting, because I'd never been in a wedding. I forgot that you actually had to sign, like, for a witness, like, legal documents right after the wedding. So I was like, it was weird. I was caught off guard. Like, I had to, like, go over and, like, sign this little marriage document to make sure it's all legal and stuff after we just had this, like, you know, huge ceremony and all this stuff. I don't know. It's just so weird. It's so weird.
It'd be cool if shit like that got phased out, but what are you saying, Dave?
Oh, the dad was just like, he was sweating so like profusely making his speech and stuff. Like, it was,
oh, they didn't know. Poor man. Oh, Dave.
I was standing right next
me.
To him, yeah. Aww, I was standing right next to him while he was making his speech, and he was just, oh, he was sweating bullets. It was horrible, but I don't know.
How many people was he talking to?
I don't know. Maybe like 100 or something. Something like that. I'm bad at estimating numbers, so I have no idea. But, you know, it was like a small church, but it was packed. Yeah. And the religious element, too. It's like, yeah, this is bringing. God has brought these two together. We'll bound them together for life. It's like, whoa now.
And are you just waiting for the eventual breakup? Are you like, oh, okay, this is going to last about 6 months?
I don't know. Like, it's really hard to tell because they're very serious about it, and I can see them. What's horrible, like the pastor, like one of the things he said was like, you know, you're going to have times, he was talking to like the groom, and you're going to have times when, you know, you're just at your wit's end, and you just don't know if you're going to be able to make it any further, but that's when you need to look back on this day and remember the vows that you've made and all this stuff and remember that, and he read some Bible passage or something, but I was like, man, that's horrible. Like that's what keeps people in horrible marriages and leads to all sorts of just abuse and just horrible. I'm not saying my friend would abuse his wife, but I'm just saying like, that's what that thinking is what leads to people being trapped in horrible marriages because they think that it's a sin. You know, it's like a horrible sin to get divorced and break up when it's just not working. That's why the whole marriage thing doesn't make sense to me. I just don't realize like people are gonna change. I don't know. Like people, I know that people do stay together whole lives, and some people are like just built for that and it works for them. But why, if you can do that, then why get married? Like, the only reason that I could see to get married, like, for legal purposes, because you're going to have kids and to have, like, a family, I guess, and then there's a bunch of legal things that it would be easier if you were married, but that's really the only reason. If you're not going to have kids, then I don't know. I don't know why you would do it.
It's also pressure from society, I guess, you know, because people kind of expect you to get married, so it's kind of like you get it from everywhere. Like, when will you get married? When will you get married? It's, like, very annoying, you know, so people cannot really...
It's illogical to think that two people are going to grow emotionally, mentally, well... not physically, emotionally and mentally at the same rate as another human being. And you're going to grow in the same direction. That doesn't, like, what happens if all of a sudden you wake up one day and decide you want to become like a botanist and originally you were some kind of, I don't know, physicist. Like, all of a sudden you have totally different interests. How is that going to mash with, you know, the person you're with?
Yeah, especially if your partner hates plants as well.
Yeah.
Seriously, though, most people do change more than they expect. Like, I read something about this. Like, it's just a fact. Most people underestimate how much they're going to change. I mean, I'm not sure. Like, people here might be more self-aware than that, and it might not apply to us so much. I don't know. But, like that kind of explains why marriages usually don't work for, you know, as long as people expect. I read it on the internet.
Great way to end.
That's awesome.
The only reason that
people believe in the marriage here or the married people, like, I don't mean to you.
Huh?
Anyone who's married or believes in marriage or anything, any of
Lisa
you.
Lisa is going to get married soon.
Yeah.
That's why she's eating.
Yeah, no, I'm like, food. That's why I'm eating.
So I can't fit. Dress.
I can't fit in a wedding. Actually, guys, the fact is I'm really considering eloping and doing like a private ceremony where there's no contract, there's no government being brought into it. The thing that I accept is that since we're living together, common law is going to come into the picture, which we wanted to live together. We accept that. Marriage, I think, is a lot more strict when it comes to the marriage contract. Like, you know, it's... So we're thinking about it, but honestly, we're engaged now. Just a way for us to commit to each other in that way, and I think that's what we wanted, just to be like, hey, we're serious, we want to be life partners, but if something happens, something happens, and we're, you know, we're just doing the best we can together. And is that another clock?
That's a phone.
No, that was my phone.
Okay.
David's phone.
Yeah, my daughter's...
The only reason marriage...
Oh, sorry. Go on.
Oh, no, go ahead.
No, my daughter's been the same guy for 8 years, so, and they never had a ceremony, but they're definitely married now. Go on. And it works for them, so.
Yeah. I think the only reason it makes sense is if you're really serious about it, like, and you're consciously making a decision to, like, almost like a spiritual thing, but, like, I am choosing to sacrifice my independence just almost as, like, a ritual, not a ritual, but, like, some kind of, like, spiritual growth thing. Like, I've heard people talk about it that way, where it's like, I'm deciding that I'm going to live the rest of my life through another person, and it's no longer about me, it's, you know, it's about us, you know, or whatever. So I can see people doing it as, like, a spiritual kind of exercise to, like, kind of get rid of the ego or whatever. I don't know. I've heard people talk about it in a way that makes sense to me, but... most people just aren't that serious about it. It's not that for 99% of the people that are getting married. They're not thinking about that. They're just like, oh, we're just going to get married because we're together and whatever. We won't have kids or something. But I see people taking it really seriously, and my friend seems to take it pretty seriously. So I predict that his marriage will be successful and long lasting, but you never know.
Oh.
It's like I can sense like the MGTOW influence, like, you know, like among us, you know, although we are all like mental health, we still talk about like MGTOW stuff, no? Doesn't it feel this way to you guys?
I don't know, Anya, you're risking the emerald hammer of justice there.
Yeah, but you guys are risking it.
No, marriage is a universal topic. It's
no,
not, but, you know.
No, they just like to talk about it, like, a lot, so.
Well,
I don't know, I think, like, just from my perspective, I think it's kind of nice to... I do like the spiritual component, like Dave is talking about. I'm not religious in the slightest, neither is Costa, and we just wanted to go somewhere really cool on vacation, exchange some vows that we, like, not even vows, but just, like, say something nice to each other and be like, hey, and then have a dinner with people we care about, but not do an actual like, wedding, integration, intention.
Integration. Merging of
finances. But,
sweaty man talking on the wedding.
I don't know. I think we celebrate together, but it's not like something that you need a contract for and to bring the government in. And I do realize that it's kind of hypocritical in a way, since we're living together, we're obviously going to be under some sort of contract after a couple years, but if you talk about what happens in a worst-case scenario and you realize how you divide things, we're both paying half-half here at this place, we're splitting chores, we're splitting expenses, we're very symbiotic with each other, I think we're in a very healthy relationship, you know? So I've seen a lot of people that live together, and one of them's mooching off the other, blah, blah, blah. But if you understand each other and you work together towards a common goal, I mean, that's the best kind of relationship you can have, in my opinion, so.
Yeah, I agree. Second that.
Yeah, well, if his common goal is getting you pregnant, and your common goal is to have a career.
yeah, that well, that's not what it is.
That's
here,
not a common goal.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, no.
No, I didn't
no, you
mean
don't
you
even
specifically.
Need...
I meant, like if that's, you know, the way some are. Because I'm pretty sure that my daughter doesn't want to have kids or just wants one kid, and it has to be a girl. And he wants a son. So there's like a little conflict there.
Yeah, well, then they shouldn't have kids. Or they shouldn't. I mean, like, or they can have a boy and a girl. Who cares? I don't know. There's ways to work out that.
Yeah, if you're that picky, you probably shouldn't get married.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, that's.
And people also change in the sense that. Right now, I'm going to be honest, you know, I'm 27, he's 33, we still don't know if you want to have a family. It's something that we're just constantly, like, do you want one, do you not? And we're going to kind of see where we end up, but it's not like one person is decided on something. It's the kind of thing where we see where we are in a few years financially and mentally and everything. Because also, I would never want to have a kid just because of some timeline. Like, I reject the timeline. Much like David Weston, of course, there's a biological timeline, but you can always still adopt. There's many options, and you should never feel forced into a certain, you know, thing. And, like, I get so friggin' mad when someone's like, so when are you having kids? When's the big day? And all that. I'm like, I'm enjoying. That's what I always say. I'm enjoying now, and we'll see. You know?
No need to rush forward.
And I get so close to being like, maybe there won't be a marriage, but then I don't say that, because, like, people will be like, oh, that's so against, like, norms, and then you'll get into a whole big philosophical debate over, you know, things that shouldn't concern that person, so. Right. It's frustrating.
That's right.
Yeah.
When's the whatever? When's this, like, obligatory thing?
Mm-hmm.
That old chestnut.
Yep.
I've been married twice. First time for 20 years, and unfortunately my bipolar disorder destroyed that marriage. And now I'm married again now for almost 15 years. Luckily my wife's a psych nurse now, and she's real good about keeping me on track.
That's good.
That's cool.
Yep. Since there's a lull here, I noticed your note, Bipolar.
Yes.
He's paying $99. It looks like you're rating that he missed a payment. So yeah, are you thinking that it's $99 every pay stub, or is it $99 per month, would you say?
I would say that's a weekly pay stub, so I would suspect he's probably paying $99 a week, which would be about the right amount for child support, for the wages that he earns. So, yeah, it just looks like he probably missed a week and they were making it up in that particular pay stub.
Oh, okay. Okay. So that was kind of misleading of him, maybe. But then again, I mean, if you're only doing 20 hours per week and you lose $100 every week, that's quite substantial, isn't it?
It is substantial. And a lot of that is just dependent upon how many children he has. And, you know, I mean, if he's supporting three kids, $99 a week doesn't even buy the groceries, so.
No. But it's just the one. But that's $400 a month, so.
Yeah, $400 a month.
And if the wife is pulling that in, I don't know. It should be. I think that's a substantial amount if he's not working enough to do a full, you know, 40-hour work week. Huh.
Yeah,
anyways, it's a sad story. Thanks for, you know, looking that up and then giving me the information.
Yeah, sure. There's a lot of unknowns there. I mean, is he, you know, is it just because he's in a region of the country that it's just tough to get a full-time job and he's doing the best he can with a part-time job? And so, you know,
Yeah, there's a lot of videos he has up. I haven't really looked at a lot.
Yeah.
So. But yeah, I just wanted to know what the pay stub was saying, so I really appreciate that.
Sure, no problem.
Okay, everyone, let's get back to Lisa's wedding.
Oh, you've made Jamal leave. Jamal's
Jamal.
Like,
Jamal, take care.
Oh,
Jamal, is there anything you want to talk about Jamal while you're here?
Yeah.
Oh.
Guess not.
Not anymore.
Guess not.
That's okay. I mean, it's hard to stay on a topic when you have multiple people in the hangout. Like before, it was just me, Anya, and Steven, and we were all kind of on topic. But when you get multiple people, I can't expect to stay on. And I don't like to stay on like the same topic anyways all the time. It's fun to kind of just go where it takes you. I don't want to be like, and now back to this. It's like we're going down a fun path, and now back to this, you know, like whatever.
I think you're avoiding the question. How many kids did you want there, Lisa?
Yeah. She doesn't want to talk about her marriage.
Oh, my God. Look at Doug being all assertive over there.
I will tell you.
I was trying to be funny, not assertive. Oh, I blew it.
I will tell you, grandchildren will change your life.
Well, grandchildren are the best when you can, you know, give them to the parents after they poop.
There is that too.
So about goal setting, I'm bringing it back. Do y'all have any goals that you're working on right now, like for real, for serious?
Why, yes, I have quite a few goals, and I just took steps to help me achieve them. And I'm not going to say anything more about that.
Oh, secret goals.
Secret goals.
Oh, no, it's not secret goals. I want to, like you, write a book and actually put it out there for public consumption.
Uh-huh.
And I want to try to make a song because I've never done that before and I'm trying to learn how to write. I'm trying to learn this, I don't know if I can show it, but like this music maker type thing, trying to learn how to use that, and it is a steep learning curve, and I find it overwhelming because there's so much to learn, and I get so tired trying to. It's like my brain's gone on a hiatus. Okay.
Yeah, they're hard to learn. Maybe you should get Music 3000 for the PS2 or something. Something that's like in between a game and a fucking actual machine for making music. But
Guitar What's that guitar game? Guitar Master?
Guitar Hero? Or
Guitar Hero.
Yeah, no, you don't make music in that, but...
I love that game.
I love that game, too.
I don't have that game.
You know what really pisses me off? If I put that energy into actually learning guitar, I'd probably be, like, decent at it. Like, I would play that game so much, and I was in, like, hard mode, and some of the games, like, some of it on expert mode, and I was doing so well, and then I'm like, why didn't I actually do it to something that you could actually use and, like...
Yeah.
Actual music, not just click, 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 you know, like, whatever.
Wasted youth. Anyway, hey, you know what, Doug, you should make soft punk hip hop like someone on a, like, annoying, dorky, kind of Vanilla Ice type dorky. Did I say dorky?
You did.
No, it was good. It was actually good. You are talented with the books. With the book and the music, it's like, damn it, where did you get this talent from? It's like you got a talent well in your garden and you just fucking pull it up.
A talent well, buckets. Yes.
You drink buckets of talent, you know?
I do, every morning.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep.
Well, I'm right then. Yep.
Okay, I'm ready for the performance, David.
What?
I'm ready for the performance.
Nope.
Why not?
Go to my channel. I don't have music.
Oh, really? Seriously? Everything.
You can't play music on this on Google Hangouts.
Oh, but
and hear
you
your voice
dancing.
At the same time.
You were dancing. On one of the Hangouts, he was dancing, right, Lisa?
Lisa was playing a video of me dancing.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
For
everyone to see.
Oh, that's what it was. Oh, okay.
Yep.
I like your dancing videos, Anya. You look really, very classic.
Oh, thank you, Doug. Classic. You're nice. That's why I call you Doug Hugs.
Yay!
Yay!
There was a skit in Saturday Night Live way back in the 80s, and I can't remember the name of the people, but they're all dressed in black. And they're doing a dance thing. And if I could remember the name, this would make a whole lot more sense, but I can't, because it was 30 years ago. Carry on. Sorry. That was totally useless. I'm sorry. You dance divinely, Anya. You dance fantastic. I enjoyed it very much.
Okay, thanks. You're making me blush now.
Oh, my job's done.
Yes, definitely.
Gotta make ladies blush, eh? Hey, you know what? Can I go on a tangent, right? I went to London recently, and I saw some bikers riding naked, and, like, this guy was on a unicycle with his, like, penis on the seat, like, kind of popping, pointing upwards, and I filmed it, and I put it on Facebook. I just thought that's more interesting than whatever you
did. Didn't you get, like didn't
is
get
that your goal? Is that how that came to your mind?
Flag? Goal setting.
Yeah, that's your goal,
yeah.
Right?
Like, yes, that's how it's related to this conversation. My goal is to ride a unicycle in London,
yeah,
naked,
yeah,
in front of loads of tourists.
Uh-huh.
And you know what? Some of their penises looked a bit erect. I think some of them, like, had
they
semis.
Probably get off on it, yeah.
Yeah, well, to be fair, it was a political thing. That was the idea. Like, I think they were legitimately doing it and everything, but some of them looked, like, too big. Like, that, they didn't look like they were... They didn't look they were semi. That was weird, but...
Mm.
Anyway, so, yeah, goal setting. Goal setting is, like, with me, it's, like, same old essay shit, like, just trying to keep my job and not kill anyone at my job.
Those are good goals.
Yeah, and,
those,
like...
Those are solid.
Yeah, like, hang out with my friends, like, my friend Paul, who I met from online, SA shit, and just shit like that. I don't have any great specific goals, but hold on to my job. That's the main one.
Yeah.
What about you, David? What about you? You still teaching, still, like, organizing the teachers and shit like that?
Yeah, well, I bought the business that I was working for, the little tutoring business, so... So now I own it, so I've got a lot of goals. I've got a lot of, like, business goals that'll happen, hopefully, in this coming year. And then, you know, I always keep all my goals written down. I'm, like, super organized about that, I guess. But, you know, I have, like, I want to run a 10K race at some point this year. I want to gain weight, so I want to weigh, like, 150 pounds by the end of the year. Right now I'm, like, 137. And I've never weighed more than like 140 in my life, so I just want to like break that. And then like I want to do like 30 minutes of meditation a day. I want to start doing yoga every day. So I've got a lot of goals, just little things like that.
Yeah, he's like my friend. He's like crazy organized. But anyway, I don't want to be too revealing because he might not like it. God damn it, he might be watching. Seriously, very secretive. Some people are.
Does anybody else have any goals that they've written down that haven't talked yet?
No.
Oh, oh you listless people.
Listless. The buzzer is like, eh.
I used to not like writing down goals. I don't know. I used to not like that because I felt like it was too much pressure. But then, I don't know. I just started to see them differently. Like they're just kind of guidelines. They're just like guidelines. I don't know. Or they're more like aims. I know I'm not gonna hit exactly all these goals this year, but it's like if I feel like I've done something today that's contributed to the goals, then I'm okay. You know. So yeah. They're just like a continual, I'm continually striving after these goals, but I don't have a deadline or anything.
Yeah, a lot of entrepreneurs and stuff, like, or, like, big believers in that, write stuff down. And,
yeah.
Like, I mean, some people say, like, you need to, like, really commit and stuff. For me, that don't work. I'm more like you where it's just, like, I try to see it as an aim and stuff, but writing stuff down can really help. Probably, especially if you're like an attention deficit spaz as well, you know. I mean, I am a bit like that, to be honest, but
yeah,
poor concentration. But like, yeah, like there really is something in writing stuff down. There really is.
Mm-hmm.
Boring as it sounds, you know, like to actually like get it done. Like, what's that guy called? Depression to expression, right? He fucking talks mm-hmm. about like, have a whiteboard and write your goals and like.
Yeah.
That way I don't know what he's like said about it, but apart from it being a good idea, but like, you know, if it's on your wall, you'll see it, won't you? It'll be like it'll always be there, you know.
Yeah.
Big fucking words. So.
Or I use this website called Workflowy, and like I've got my calendar on there and everything. So every day when I like look at my calendar and stuff, I've got my goals there too. So I look at it every day. So yeah, same idea.
I've been doing it all wrong, though. I've been using like a whiteboard for meal planning instead of goal planning. oh well.
If your goal is to eat healthier, like
that's true.
Meals, then there you go.
It all fits in. But yeah, I personally, like, seriously, I make a lot of lists too, and like I do like more daily checklists of things I want to achieve, and then I'll do bigger goals like on another list, so that's not like mixed in, so it's not like accomplish this huge task and then do the laundry, so I'm not like you know, so
yeah,
that way you separate it out. And I also find like that organization helps a lot, but it's better to accomplish one or two big tasks a day than to try and get through a whole list, or else you might end up at the end of the day doing nothing. That's what I've noticed, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, I mean, if there's like big things you want to focus on, and then you say, I'm going to spend a few hours doing this or a few hours doing that, instead of being like, okay, I need to do these 90 things in one day, because it's just not going to happen. So.
Yeah.
Well, when you're retired, it's kind of the goals kind of go away. It's, you know, it's kind of like get up, take a shower, eat a banana. You know? So I have very limited goals in my life.
Yeah, I guess goals aren't necessary. You don't have to have goals, but that's what I'm always like flip-flopping between like wanting to not have any goals and just like live every day just in the flow of things and like not planning anything and just seeing what happens. But then I just realize that my life gets pretty boring when I do that. So I've got to have some lofty goals, yeah. You know,
well,
that I write down and like
yeah.
I'm working towards, you know.
I had a full day planner when I was working in the IT business, you know, so mm-hmm. It's kind of nice to have put that away in
a
box
break.
Now.
Yeah.
Take a break, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And I try to, I always like check back and look over my goals every once in a while to make sure, like, am I doing this because I feel like I should do it? Or am I doing this because I really enjoy doing this and
yeah.
I actually want to do this? Because it doesn't matter, like, I don't know. I just always got to check myself because sometimes I just get caught in goals And I'm like, and then I realized one day, like, why am I doing this? I'm not enjoying the process of doing this. If I don't enjoy the process, then, like, I don't, because I enjoy doing yoga or, like, working out or whatever. So, like, I'm going to keep doing that. But as soon as I stop enjoying it, then I'm going to get rid of the goal.
That's a great point, David.
Yeah.
Yeah, you need a list of goals to review. That's what you need.
To some review?
Goals might be in doubt. Yeah, so you need to start lists of goals to actually review. It's a joke. Fucking laugh. Anyway, what are you going to say? What's this guy called? Bipolar XFD,
yeah.
Right?
That's Steven, yeah.
That's Steven. I need to change that so it comes up as Steven.
Yeah, I like when people use their real names on the internet.
Yeah, I do too. I'm new to the thing here, so I haven't quite figured out all the quirks.
Yep.
You're saying something. You were going to say something. But you put us in a lull where fucking David feels obliged to say yep. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
All right, fuck you, Steve.
Oh, goodness, whoa.
Where did that come from?
Oh. Fuck you.
It's every once in a while.
Hey, so you want to know about my London trip, right? I know you're all gagging. So
fuck you.
What? Anyway,
what did you see besides naked unicyclists?
I went to the top of a building called the Fenchurch Building, yeah, which is one of the tallest buildings in the country, probably, and it has like a garden on top of it, and it's like a fucking spaceship or something. Feels like you're in Elysium if you've seen that film. It was cool. That's cool. Yeah, fucking. Went to Buckingham Palace and shit. Yo, you guys, like, travel, like, what's the best, like, places you've traveled to and that? Anyone been anywhere great? Like,
I don't think I've ever left Canada, so I've never been farther east than Saskatchewan. There you go.
I've never gone overseas.
Went to Vancouver once, woohoo, or twice.
That's one of my goals, though, is to travel overseas. That's one of my... Because I've never been. I almost went on a study abroad trip in college to London, but I didn't. I backed out at the last minute, and I regret it. So that is one of my goals.
Another goal.
Yeah, I've got them all written down. It's a big list. It's a big list.
The problem with traveling when you have social anxiety is to enjoy the trip. I mean, you go, you spend all this money, you spend all this time, you go to a different country, and you want to see, let's say, the Louvre, and all you're doing is you're there, terrified about being in public. So you can't enjoy the experience, you can't take in and absorb the culture, the people. All you're doing is, like, getting sicker and sicker and sicker because you can't escape into... your safe zone, because your safe zone's like, you know, 2,000-3,000 miles away.
Yeah, that's one thing. Yeah, I like having a place that I know I can go back to. But with the social stuff, like when you're traveling, I don't have hardly any social anxiety traveling because I know that I'm never going to see these people again. So like, there's not the pressure of doing anything wrong, because I'm like, I'm never going to see these people again in my life. So I have much less when I'm other places.
So if you go to other places, you'll be the naked unicyclist.
Yeah, why not? Never going to see these people again.
I was going to say that.
I should try that.
You're anonymous. Like, I was going to say that. Like just because someone's got SA problems doesn't mean they have every kind of SA, you know. They might be fine with situations where they're anonymous and just transient, you know, or it could be the opposite, you know. But like, I'm kind of like David, like that sort of, but like, I was with a friend, like, and he totally gets my SA, so that really, that makes like being in public, like around people, so easy. In fact, I look like an obnoxious twat at times, honestly, because I know I'm not going to see them, and he's got my back and everything, even though he finds a lot of it to be quite odd, whatever. But I'll walk around with a t-shirt saying, like, I hear voices and they don't like you, and I'll just be a bit odd. And I have, like, self-harm scars, and it's weird. Like, I've been to London twice, and one was not long after I'd done the self-harm, like two big chunky scars, and I felt okay, like going to London and like with short sleeves, which I didn't where I live, and since then I've had long sleeves obsessively, pretty much all the time, and now I go back to London and I take them back to short sleeves just so it's cooler, you know, because the weather and that, but like it's funny, I was seen by a crazy amount of people, like so thousands and thousands and thousands of tourists, but I didn't even care about the scars, whereas, you know, at work or whatever, it's like fucking 10 people, or in my town I live in, yeah. Like, you know, it's hardly anyone that recognizes, you know, it's like, you know what I mean, it's just counterintuitive, but that's just fucking anxiety and shit for you.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, it makes sense. Because, like, you're stuck with it. Because you're afraid, like, if you do something wrong or, like, give someone the wrong impression of you that's close to you, then you're stuck with them. You're stuck with your coworkers and stuff. So that's the fear. But yeah, if you're traveling, you don't have to ever see those people again. So there's no fear there. That makes sense to me.
But here's something that don't make sense. Like, the people I'm afraid of seeing the scars, like, when I'm in my town, are not people that will recognize me, I don't think. I think they're the people... like, it's weird. If I went around to this hostel that I used to live in, I wouldn't be bothered about my scars being out. But it's just the people in the town. Like, there's going to be some extra nasty person in my town, in my local area, that's going to turn into a terrorist of me. Or something. It's fucking... Mm. Like, it's crazy. Anxiety's mad. If you try and flesh it out, that can help, like... You know, it makes it look ridiculous, but it is, you know, it is illogical anyway, so...
Yeah,
scars. Trigger warning. I was late with the trigger warning.
But... A little bit, Lewis. But for myself, I get a lot of anxiety traveling, but it's more... I get a ton of general anxiety, just knowing, like, I'm always worried about going to the wrong place or doing the wrong thing, so I get really stressed out just airports, like, you know, making sure you're there on time and going through security. I get very intimidated, and, like, for me... I think the best way to challenge your anxiety is to kind of go out of your comfort zone like that. So I've actually gone on a lot of trips because I used to do a lot of scuba diving trips, and that was a huge push for me because I'm a very, like, low-key person, and then I'll go and do all these dives, or I'm diving with sharks or diving at night and things that are so out of my comfort zone that I secretly love, but it takes a huge push. And then most of these people you meet are like, oh, yeah, I'm also, like, I do extreme, like, motor, you know, but like motocross or whatever, and they're like, I go parachuting every weekend, and I'm just like, I'm just like, you know, studying science, and I like going on extreme sea diving trips, so it's like, you have to have this huge, like, push. And so I've been to, like, Dominican before, and I've been to Cuba, and I've been to Honduras, and I've been to a lot of places just because I wanted to go on these trips and to push myself and challenge myself. And the crazy part is, it scares me more sometimes going through the airport than it does actually, like, talking to people about, like, their diving experiences and stuff. I have more general anxiety, which is a form of social anxiety because you're scared of what people are going to think of you if you do something wrong, right? So that's what I experience the most of.
How was diving in Cuba? We're not allowed to go there in the U.S. So.
I know. Well, when I went back then, I did snorkeling. That was quite a few years back. I went with my mom. But for diving, it has mainly been Bahamas, actually. Bahamas and Honduras is where I went for diving. I went to Bahamas twice, and that was really awesome. So.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Have you ever gone to Cozumel?
Have I been there?
Yeah.
No, is that Mexico?
Yeah, it's off the coast of Mexico, yeah. It's a beautiful dive, absolutely gorgeous dive, worth looking into.
I'd love to. My biggest dream in the future is to go to the Galapagos Islands, just because I'm a biologist, like, so I'm really interested in that kind of life. So I really want to eventually see, you know, that kind of stuff, because apparently you have to do kind of the diving other places, and when you go there, you see the hammerhead sharks and the swimming lizards and all this crazy life that doesn't exist, like, in too many places in the world, so.
Wow.
Are you in a cage or what? Like, I was going to ask you earlier. No, are you more afraid of, like, the airport or sharks? Because,
you
know.
No, it's going to
ask that. The airport, I'm not even kidding. This is just, actually, there was someone on here, if you guys know Emma, who does videos here, Emma Wicks. She talks about mental health too, and she was saying how once she was scared of when she was in an appointment and something was burning her, and she was scared of like actually admitting it and having her social anxiety. Like, I would be scared if a shark bit me of what people would think, and my blood's in the water and all this attention is on me, and I'm like, don't look at me.
That's
like,
horrible.
Fine, you know? Social anxiety or what? I'm like, it's like your life and then your what people think of you, right? And it's so stupid, but obviously that's an extreme example that's not true. I'd be like, oh my god, I'm dying. But
yeah.
I didn't get scared of the sharks. I loved it. Part of me feels like that's something that I have to do a lot more of in the future, because it's a really big thing for me, and I'm trying to get a job now in a place where they have, you know, tanks and you can scuba dive there and you work as a biologist, and I could do a nice job like that. So that would be amazing, like as at least a stepping stone for career wise. That would be really cool. So.
Oh, good luck with that.
Wait, are you trying to are you going to be some biologist type person that's like using all your qualifications and then go and be a counselor or what?
Well, that's the plan. I've been, speaking of goals and stuff, I've been looking into a lot of career options. I'm actually interested, I'm sure like Steven knows a lot about this, but psychiatric nursing and stuff like that, like you mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking into something where you're working with people kind of on a one-on-one basis, so either counseling or nursing or something where I can take some more psychology classes. And then kind of make my way into that. But I wouldn't mind working as a biologist for now, because I'm also very interested in research. If you guys know Dark Knight on YouTube, he does a lot of stuff about research and biology, and I love that stuff. So I'm thinking about maybe going into that for a bit. And the cool thing about careers is you can really just kind of feel things out and go for different things and see what feels right. You don't have to feel like you're trapped in something forever. So, you know, people change. Right, yeah. Immortal?
I think you're asking that at the wrong time when I just jumped in.
No, I'm kidding. I know. Yeah. I just put you on the spot for no reason, man. How are you?
I'm okay. How long has this been going on for?
Since a couple hours ago. It's been almost 2 hours.
Oh, shoot. So it's probably almost at its conclusion, huh?
Yeah, but we'll do an after party. Don't you worry.
Okay.
Yeah, I've got to go eat lunch. I'm starving, so okay. I'm gonna head out. This is cool. I'm glad you restarted these.
Yeah, thanks for
coming. I feel like it's been forever.
It has.
See you later.
I reheated something for you, David. So it's in the kitchen.
Why would you say that? Oh, no.
So, Lisa, when you're under the water, like you're traveling in these foreign places and you're under the water, do you feel like that's a safe place for your social anxiety? Are you sitting there going, I'm underwater, I'm scuba diving, nobody's around, and that's like a safe place? That's where you feel the least amount of social anxiety? Or like when traveling, or is it in your hotel room?
Yeah, that's a good question. Well, the truth is when I go on these scuba diving trips, you're usually on a liveaboard, so you're in a very small boat with a lot of people, so you have no choice but to mingle. That's the best way. Like, honestly, it goes from the start of the week, everyone, if you bump into someone by accident, you're like, sorry, you're so awkward, it's so weird, but by the end, you're like a family because you have to be in such close quarters the whole time, and there's alcohol, and there's talking, and there's, you know...
Anxiety more than alcohol.
No, and then your depression comes out, and you're like, I'm miserable now. But you know what? Underwater, you still have to communicate, because you have to have a buddy, because you have to make sure that in case of an emergency, you have someone near you, because I did rescue diving as well, and you have to make sure you understand how to help someone in a situation and all that. So, underwater, I just feel very at peace. For me, the ocean and the water is just, it's very meditative for me. I really enjoy it.
I agree with you.
Yeah, very relaxing.
That's interesting. Is there any place, I assume there isn't any place that's really close by that you can do the diving stuff?
Actually, yes. There's some man-made lakes and stuff, but the problem is here in Quebec, it's extremely cold, and you have to put on... it actually is very claustrophobic for me, because you have to put on all these layers, and you have to wear, like, a hood, and then you have your scuba equipment, and it's, like, very, very heavy. I think at one point I had, like... Because the tank itself is very heavy out of the water, of course, and so I think I had, like, 40 pounds of just extra stuff on me at one point, and I felt so suffocated, and I don't enjoy diving here, to be honest with you, although there's some really cool wreck diving you can do just in Ontario, like the next province over, so I would love to do that at some point, but the tropical diving is, like, amazing, you know, and I love that, so.
The water, I assume, is so warm that it's, like, body temperature.
Yeah, you really can just go in your regular bathing, so you can wear a very light wetsuit if you want. Like, sometimes at night it's cold, but night diving is friggin' awesome. Like, I remember going on this dive once where, because you have your flashlight and you're going around underwater, and you're just in the open ocean, and I remember at one point turning off my flashlight, and there were these things, I think they were called bloodworms, and they glow in the dark, so you just turn it off and you just watch all these, like, lights around you, and I was like, this is so magical.
Yeah, it's so much more colorful at night.
Yeah, it's amazing.
So these animals are, like, luminescent?
Some of them, yeah.
Like fireflies at night? Yes, yeah. You can see them? Wow.
It's really, really cool. And then I remember once I turned my flashlight on and there was a shark, and I'm like, yep, I'm not doing that again. And you guys know sharks feed at night, so, like, I'm not going to stay on this dive too long because that makes me uncomfortable. But, I mean, everyone gets really, you know, nervous about these things. And I'm sure you guys know, like, there's all different kinds of marketing. So there's, like, those, you know, the techniques they use for, like, fear, where I remember seeing this ad in my magazine, and you just see this girl swimming in the water, and it's an open ocean, and there's a shark, and then she says something like, good thing I'm wearing Tampax or something, and I'm like, oh, my God. But apparently that's all a myth. It has to be, like, fresh cut blood. And once, actually, I got cut during a dive, and I would get a lot of nosebleeds, which was really scary because I don't handle the pressure too well. For a while, I was thinking about being a scuba diving instructor, but the pressure is very harsh, and it would actually give me, like, I got a sinus infection once and I had nosebleeds because my ear canals are very small. Like, you guys probably see, I have small little ears anyways, but the inside's actually small too, and I was almost deaf as a child because of just water getting in, and it was very hard for me to fix that problem, so I would get a lot of ear infections and stuff, so it wouldn't be a good career option for me just, like, physically, which sucks, so I just never pursued it, so.
So you're saying when you go down, like, 100 feet, the pressure is so great that it causes you to have, like, fluids come out of your body, like blood?
Well, the interesting thing is, well, it can burst your capillaries, so that's what happens. Like, even around my nose, I have burst capillaries sometimes, just redness, and it's the pressure actually for the first 15 feet is greater than if you descend even more. So the funny thing is, it's the first bit, and once you've gotten down and you can equalize so that your eardrums are, like, you know, used to the pressure and everything, then you're fine. But it's really the first beginning that's really hard, so I could never do, some people do free diving where they just go in without scuba gear, they dive as deep as they can, spearfish something, and then come back up. I couldn't do that because you have to be really fast, and I can't equalize that fast because of my ears. So I take a longer time getting down than some people, but once I'm down there, there's no pressure, there's no issue. So it's just a mechanical thing that I experienced.
Have you ever been down so far that you actually, when got up too fast, you got the bends?
No.
I'm not exactly sure what the bends are, but...
Yeah, that's very, very dangerous, but I've been very careful because you have to stop for 3 minutes. I think it's at 15 feet. I'm a little rusty because it's been a while and I miss it so much, but and you have to stop and allow your body to rid itself of the excess nitrogen because that's basically what it is, and you can get... What's very common is nitrogen narcosis, where you... feel underwater drunk because of having too much nitrogen in your system. And I saw this guy chasing an octopus at like 130 feet, and I'm like, hey.
Like, you need to come up.
Yeah, because people actually can get hurt because they get so distracted by, like, you feel loopy sometimes. It's really weird, and I've experienced that before. I remember once, like, on my first certification to 100 feet, I was sitting at the bottom, and this was in Quebec, and there was a lot of silt, so you have all this, like, the visibility is really low, and I remember I was sitting on a rock looking at my fins and smiling, and I was like, like, and my friend was having a panic attack underwater, and I was smiling, but the instructor was with us, so it wasn't dangerous, but she told me, like, what the hell are you doing, and I was like, smiling and looking at my fins when, before going for the dive, I was, like, losing my mind, I was so scared, you know, so,
Hey, what? So that's not the bends, though, is it? When you're drunk on nitrogen, what is the bends?
The bends is when you have actual air, I believe, that can get into your brain. It's like nitrogen, like bubbles almost. And then if it goes into your brain, it can cause like clotting. It can go to different areas and cause problems. So it's not like lethal if it, of course, doesn't go to your brain, but it's possible to go there. So you need your body to kind of rid itself at a lower pressure. So that's why you ascend very slowly, and then you stop for a while to let your body just kind of like get used to it. This is my understanding. I'm not very technical. If my friend is listening to
this, you're right
now,
on.
Yeah, okay. Because my friend is doing dive instructor. She knows this stuff. She's very, and I'm like, I hope I remember correctly, like the science behind this. So, because if you just ascend to the surface, also you could experience, is it pulmonary embolism, or it's like when your lungs like convert,
right. Yeah. Right? Pulmonary anemia, I think it's called. Pulmonary thrombosis.
Yes, that sounds right. That's it. So it's very dangerous. So you have to, when you go up, you have to always exhale as well, because sometimes you do have to go up. But if you're at a very, like, if you're not too deep and you go up really fast, sometimes you're okay, but you have to be very careful, you know, because then you can get into things like technical diving where you're going hundreds of feet underwater, and that's like, you need tons of training, you need extra equipment of everything. I remember when I was in Honduras listening to this guy who's a tech diver explaining his experience, and I was just there, and I was like drunk, and I'm in awe, and I'm like, what? Like, you did that, you know? He's like talking about being at like 150 feet underwater and like changing his tanks and switching to a different air mix and all this, and I'm like, I couldn't do that. That's just too brave, you know? So it's intense. Like, you can get into some diving. I was even thinking about doing ice diving at one point, because you can do that locally, but that's friggin', I don't know, man. That's back cold. When I was a little bit braver. Yeah, cold. So, I don't know. It's, and your regulator, the thing you breathe with, can freeze, and it just...
And then you die because you have no oxygen?
Well, you can... Freeze. People are, you have a lot of supervision and a lot of people watching you that can, like, there's a rope you follow down, and then you can, someone can help pull you out, but it's still pretty scary. Like, because there's a lot of certifications you can get. You can get deep diver certification. You can get fish identification if you're interested in the biology. You can get wreck diving. I want to learn how to go into spaces where you have overhead environments, because you're not supposed to go into things if you're not certified, because it's dangerous. So obviously you can get stuck on something, or you could even break like part of the wreck or mess it up, and if it's something that, you know, you have to be careful around, that's not good for the history and everything. So
how about shark, you have to get certified for sharks,
like, no,
animals, or is it just part, just something you have to deal with?
They'll let you in if you just have your open water. So the first stage is you're certified to 60 feet, and the second is to 100 feet. So I did 60, then 100, then I did my rescue diver, which is just a precaution in case something goes wrong, because I felt like I'd feel safer having that. And my friend did the same thing, and we were buddies on these dive trips. So it was my friend that really got me into it, because I was originally going to go into marine biology just as my subject, but I ended up going into just liberal program in biology, because I ended up taking, like, astrophysics and neuroscience and meteorology and all different things, because I just wanted to know what I liked, you know. So I took a ton of science in university, so they said, you took so many courses, we're just going to make you a liberal program. So I said, all right, and that's what I ended up doing. So
you can specialize later on.
Yeah, it was more like a concentration that you could take, but it's not going to give you anything. If you said, I did biology with a concentration in marine, it doesn't really matter. You could do a master's in marine biology if you wanted, but my grades aren't that great because of depression and mental health.
Yeah.
So even though I was very capable and I understand the science and I love it, I always felt I lacked the confidence to excel in school. That's the actual issue, because I would understand it. And I remember I was consulting with someone recently that was like, just so you know, if you go into psychology, like art psychology, it's going to be very hard, and like, be prepared. I'm like, I did neuroscience, like, I can do art psychology, do you know what I mean? And I just had this, like, moment of grandiosity where I'm like, I can do that, like, what are you talking about, you know? So, and then I realized that, you know what, sometimes I don't give myself enough credit for what I've done. And, of course, there's people that are a lot more intelligent than me and that do, you know, go into, you know, they become surgeons or, you know, doctors and all this. But, I mean, I do understand the science and I enjoy it. So I'm trying to find a way to continue doing that, but to also help people, so... That's the issue.
Yeah, no, you sound like really enthralled with the scuba diving thing and the, that sea water type stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I'm having like a moment.
That's okay.
Lisa, is that when you're the happiest?
Well, as you can see, I got really passionate talking about it. So for me, the things that make me the happiest are helping other people. And yeah, just being in nature. Just, I'm going to say, not even just the scuba diving, but just being camping or being on a hike. Sometimes I'd watch David Weston's vlogs where he's just on a hike and it would make me so happy. And I remember one of his vlogs at the end, he's in a tent and he's showing like the stars. I'm like, oh man, like I miss that. So yeah, I love that.
Do you go camping often? Do you, Rasa, go out to outside the city lights just to look at the stars?
Yeah, actually Ontario has a lot of that. So I'm going to be going this summer with my mom for at least a couple of days.
Hey.
Stephen,
ooh,
it's your clocks, man.
I'm sorry. I am so sorry.
It's okay. But I love camping, so I'm going to try and get out there again. But it's the scuba diving that, it's just because it's an extremely, extremely expensive hobby. So,
no.
Yeah, that's the problem. And I don't own my own equipment except for the basics. You need to buy, like, your fins, your mask. But if you were to buy your own BCD, which is, like, your inflation device and, like, your regulator and the hoses and all that, it's a lot of money. I think it's only really worth it if you are well off or if you want a career in that, right? Then you should own it. But I can't afford that right now, and I'd rather kind of invest into doing my YouTube stuff for now and furthering my education and stuff than to do that, which is kind of just a side interest that, you know. So.
Wait a minute. You
actually,
don't have
it is too vulnerable, right?
What?
And your body gets crushed by the water and your ears get full.
Yeah.
Exactly, and then I'm killing myself, essentially. So.
But if it wasn't for that stuff, maybe you would have gone into it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, true.
Anyway, what was Doug or someone about to say?
No, I was saying that the regulator, that's the thing that goes in your mouth, right?
Mm-hmm.
Don't you have your own? Like, doesn't everyone have to buy their own just because there's so many pathogens and things that you can get if you...
No,
I couldn't do it. I'd be like looking at this thing going, how many mils have this been in? I cannot do it.
They sanitize those for sure.
That anything's been on, but anyway.
Well, it's the same thing if you play a musical instrument from school, right? And then all the students use it, but they just hopefully disinfect them. I didn't do anything like that.
Or a whole vagina.
Oh my God! Is this turkey?
And Lisa, you know what was crazy is I mean it was one of the most tragic events in human history. But it's actually related to diving because they were documenting the 2004 tsunami that was just so destructive, right? And the story was told from several people, either individuals or families, and they recall because when you're out in open water, you don't see a tsunami coming. It's like this massive 100-foot wave, right? It's almost invisible, right? And so offshore, off the country that was hit, these people were actually diving. And they were good, competent divers, but they'll never forget, they said, when the tsunami was actually in the open water, but they obviously couldn't see it. And when they hit the water, when they dove in, they say it was like they had just landed in a whirlpool. They had no control over what was going on. They were like, are we the worst divers ever, or what the hell's going on? They said the current was so strong, it just took them wherever, they just had to go wherever the current was going. And they said probably the more ominous thing, they were reef diving, they said there were no fish. Like, there was nothing. There was no sea life out there, and it's almost like, yeah, even the marine life knew that shit was about to hit the fan, and they were like, yep, we're going to go into hiding. But I can't imagine being dropped into an environment like that where you're pretty much in the middle of a tsunami and you have no idea, and you're trying to dive through that.
That's terrifying, because I've been in some currents before, but obviously, like, I mean, even sometimes I'll do a dive called a drift dive, where you go in with very little air, because, like, usually when you do diving, I mean, I'm sure you guys have seen the movies or shows where divers, they go backwards, and they go into the water like that, and do, like, a little, like, barrel roll, surf box, and then they, you know, they just continue their diving from there, but... I've never done that. That's not a normal thing. You see it in movies all the time, and it's, like, so badass. And usually what you do is a giant stride where you just put one foot out over the boat and you just drop into the water. And so we did this dive where like, and usually have a little bit of air in your BCD so that when you go in, you come back up to the surface a little bit, right, so that you're not just plummeting. But we did this dive where we went in with, like, half air, and you go in, and then it was called, the dive was called the whirlpool, and it was natural currents that just kind of carry you through the water, and then they bring you in, like, a whirlpool, and then eventually you end up out of there, and you just keep going, and you just don't swim, you just let it happen, and it was really weird. It was scary, but it was super fun. So
did it take you down?
A little bit, but you don't go that deep. It's not like it's bringing you really far down, but the dive is probably, like, if I were to guess, 30 feet or something. You know, it wasn't a deep dive, but it was something where the current just takes you. So you go in without the buoyancy, basically, and it's really, really cool.
That sounds interesting.
Hey, yeah. Zane's got to go, so I might as well say goodbye to him.
Bye, Zane. Thanks for coming.
Bye, Zane. Sorry, Zane. Low.
See ya. Oh, man. Now, guys, I want to go diving so badly. I could have an underwater marriage, right?
There you could.
I know. That would be pretty cool.
Does your hubby know how to dive?
Well, the thing is, we've been wanting to go for a long time. He's never tried it before, but he's very into, like, he loves the whole extreme thing. Like, his thing is cycling, so he's trying to go on. Do you guys know, is this, like, a common thing, velodrome? Do you guys know what a velodrome is?
Nope.
No? It's, like, where people go for cycling races, and it's, I think it's at a 45-degree angle or something, almost, where it's a track where you're literally just going around this kind of, like, tilted track, and you're cycling and you're racing, and that's what he enjoys.
Yeah, that's an Olympics event. I've seen the Olympic event type thing.
Yeah, I've seen that too.
Call that.
Yeah, so that's his passion. So he likes kind of those extreme things, like, and he's always up for adventures and stuff, so that's probably why we get along so well, because I enjoy the diving, and he's also loves surfing, for instance. So I was making a joke that I'll be like, I'll be below the water, you'll be above the water, it's cool, you know. And so it was just funny because at one point we went, like, back to the marriage topic, we went to one of those big bridal expositions thing, and there were just people everywhere, and they're, like, throwing pamphlets at you, and my social anxiety was through the roof, and it's, like, this dress, and this catering, and this thing, and then after I looked at him, and I'm like, do you want to elope? And he's like, actually, and I'm like, I was like, this isn't doing it for me. The only thing that I spent a long time at was a scuba diving booth, and I even knew the people in the booth, so it was cool. I was like, hey, guys. And they were actually, like, promoting the underwater marriage thing, you know? Like, so people do that. People go scuba diving. They exchange vows. I really don't know how they exchange vows. They have, like, a whiteboard or something, and then it's like, or they just, like, signal things to each other, so.
More code.
Oh, yeah. You know, Lisa, you know it would be fun? At least from what I saw, if I don't know what the average wedding cost is in Canada, but if it's anything like in America where it's 30 grand plus, mm-hmm. you know, you'd be better served, like you're saying, if you just want to trade vows, do that and just pocket the 30 grand and then go buy your own scuba gear.
Amen.
And he buys a new bike. It's perfect.
I know, exactly. Like, put that money into making your lives better and not throw it away at a party.
Well, yeah, this is what I was discussing before. We were thinking about maybe eloping somewhere really awesome and then just doing a dinner with close friends and family. And it won't be the whole ceremony and the buying the dresses and all this stuff. I mean, I would rather have a bikini as my wedding thing than a full-blown dress. Like, let's go scuba diving. So, you know, because, like, I've seen so many weddings where it's just so stressful and so much money is poured into it and half the guests look like David Kaye right now yawning. And it's just like... You know, so it's not something that people need to do. They don't need to throw all this money in. And how many people do the wedding and they divorce right after because of friggin' finances? I mean, you know?
You know what? I'd sell my kidney for $30,000. I would not. Yeah. So people did. People in, like, third world countries and that, like, sell. I mean, it's not funny at all in the slightest, but they sell it for, like, money like that, you know?
Yeah.
It's crazy. Like, I think, like, that's crazy, but I think for a wedding, that's also crazy to spend that much, you know? But, hey, tangents, but, yeah, I was going to mention it earlier because I saw on the Young Turks, like, how much weddings cost, and it is just fucking insane. Like, but, I mean, I'm a poor person.
No.
David, you're a poor person. You're a baker's son, and you're not speaking. You should tell us what's going on.
Well, to give a different perspective about weddings, it all depends how rich your friends and family are. My uncle and my cousin got married, and there's like about 2,000 people there, and they spent about 20,000, 30,000 on the wedding, but they got in gifts a hell of a lot more. So if your family's rich and you're going to get a lot of gifts that are going to make up and go beyond, then having a wedding is financially sound. It's when you have very cheap parents, like, depression-era parents, getting married is not a good idea.
Hmm. How can you in good conscience ask parents to fund something so vain? I mean, it might make more sense if it's something that you have a legitimate need for, like, hey, I would need your help for something that's necessary for like life and living. But that's an indulgence that really doesn't need to be funded, to be honest.
In this case, it was more a wedding to allow business colleagues and friends to gather and celebrate who he is. And I'm talking the father. I'm not talking the person having the wedding, the daughter. I'm talking, it was a father. Look at me. Come, these are all my friends. I'm going to rent out the motel. It was stupid.
Yeah.
For our kids, we gave them each $10,000, which we had put in savings, you know, all along. For them, and we told them that they could do whatever they wanted with it. They could, you know, have a small wedding or have no wedding and take the money and go on a trip or take the money and put it on a house or, you know, it was whatever they wanted to do with it, but that was our gift to them for getting married.
Yeah, just on a side note, they got divorced. They had a kid, got divorced about a year later, and the father ended up having to call the cops on the now ex-husband. It was a disaster. The entire marriage was a disaster. But he got his wedding out of it, so yay him.
Yeah, you know? It sounds like the wedding was about him more than the actual couple.
I think so. I wouldn't say that to his face because he'd have me killed, but I would say that, yeah, that's exactly what it was. It was all about the father.
Yeah, and that's the struggle with these things, right? Because you want to make the family happy, but also the day is really about the two of you. It's not about the parents. And that's a bit of my concern because I actually kind of said quietly to my mom one day, I was like, I mean, you know, because I know some people elope and they just go for it, and then after they tell everyone, everyone's like, well, right, you got married? But some people are honest about it, right? Welcome back, Zane. I told my mom about it, and she was actually like, I can totally see you guys doing that, and I'm cool with that. And she didn't have any issues with it, but my fiancé's side of the family is Greek, traditional. Mm. Might be a problem with that, but at the same time, we have to keep in mind what we want. So I figured a good compromise is you run away, you do your thing together, and then you have a dinner with the family, and you honor them, too. And then you still get gifts.
Yay!
Yeah. I was like, hey! Because, like, if you do a dinner, let's say, and it's kind of like you do a reception, and you do a bar, and you enjoy that, yes, it's going to be expensive, but you don't have the ceremony, you don't have the dresses, you don't have the whole government thing, you're just celebrate your time together, and your honeymoon and your little elopement is all rolled in together. I'm like, I like this idea. So it's pretty
cool. Just make sure his family is good with it, because if you end up offending that side of an entire side of the family, it can destroy your relationship from then on.
Yeah, but I lived with his family for a couple years, and I think we're on good terms and stuff, and they understand the kind of person I am, and it would be the kind of thing that I'm pretty sure we would be honest with and tell them before we went and did something like this. We'd be like, we're just telling you, this is our plan, we're going to do a dinner, we're going to include you guys. And so that way, in my mind, it includes everyone, but we do what we want. And also, my fiancé's past work was being a wedding photographer, so he's been to so many weddings that he's like really cool with just eloping and doing something completely different. So
Lisa, you've yeah. mentioned this a couple of times. What you say the whole government thing, is there something in Canada that we don't have in the U.S. as far as government control over marriages and things?
Well, I think it's just in general. It's like I just hear all this negativity about, you know, doing an actual marriage contract, and I'm sure there are some advantages to it as well. I mean, I'm sure it's not just, it was completely detrimental to both people when it exists. So obviously there's advantages for at least one person, which might be the whole problem.
Right. I understand what you're saying now. Yeah.
But to be honest with you, right now, currently my fiance and I are making about the same, you know, hourly wage. So it's not like either of us has a huge advantage over the other. But the truth is, I'm likely going to pursue a career that will be making more money anyways. So then I have inheritance money, he has inheritance money. It's better just say we're doing our own thing, we're going to keep our finances separate, but we're going to both contribute the same amount to our living and our expenses and all that stuff, but just not lump everything together. That just, to me, makes the most sense.
As opposed to doing a prenuptial or something like that, then.
Yeah, exactly. That's it. Yeah. The thing is, people do change. I've heard the marriage statistics a billion times. I've seen it before my eyes, and sometimes it works out for sure, but I think you have to be clear and realistic and honest about these things and not just think, well, mine's the fairy tale happy ending, obviously, and everyone else is just a statistic. Like, no, that's not
how
it works. And you can't control your partner. Your partner could run off and do something. People change. Even if you're 100% confident in yourself, you can never... Mm-hmm. be sure that a relationship's going to work out. So
You're right.
You know what people don't ask? It's kind of funny because the marriage license is one of the many, you know, products or services that the state sells you. But so you have to look at it as it's a transaction. They're selling you something, right? So if it's a transaction, you have to ask, okay, you're not the only one gaining from this transaction. The person selling you whatever it is also gaining something from you. But people aren't asking, wait, okay, so if I buy this from the state, what did they just get from me? You get what I'm saying? Like, no one's asking that question. Like, what did I just give the state power over when I made this purchase? And if it's any sort of competent business, any business will always benefit more from the transaction than the consumer. That's if they are a good business. So, but no one's asking that. They're like, oh shit, what did I just what did the state just gain for me when I made this purchase? So people need to start asking that.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point.
Mm-hmm. But obviously these things are never completely black and white, and I mean, it's just funny sometimes when I'll ask, because a lot of people say in a certain community, they say, well, obviously if you have this contract and then the woman initiates the divorce, which is 70% of all cases, and I've heard the statistics all the time. But what happens if the female makes more money than the male? What happens then? Doesn't the male have, you know, get alimony and all this stuff? Doesn't that happen? I mean, and more women are working and having higher paying jobs and things like that, regardless of gynocentrism or whatever you want to say, right? Sometimes the female's a breadwinner, so isn't the man going to collect the alimony?
It's have you seen that?
Protect both people, you know?
Yep. Yeah, have you seen that Anne Heche video? And he was she was talking with, I think, David Letterman, and talking about it, her ex-husband. What did you do today, ex-husband? Ooh, I got a check from Anne Heche. Yay!
Oh my God, I didn't see that.
Was bitter. Oh, was she bitter?
Yeah.
It was funny though. But
I mean, that's the thing. I think your earnings should be your earnings.
I think regardless of the role reversal, no one's entitled to money that is not theirs. So I wouldn't care who it is. I think if that's a woman's money and some court intervenes and says you need to give up money that is yours and fork it over to some, like, you know, state-sanctioned theft, I don't endorse that, whether it's a woman having her money taken or a man having her money taken. If people need to just break up because they said we're not compatible anymore, they need to go their separate ways, and no judge needs to be in a courtroom saying, your assets are going here and your assets are going over here. That's not their fucking business. It's not. If it's your romance, if it fails, you need to be able to walk away free and say, whatever I came into the relationship with is mine. Whatever you came into the relationship with is yours. You go that way, I go this way, and that's it. There's no reason to involve a judge. None.
Yeah.
That is just stupid.
I agree. The only caveat I would put on that is that which is earned within the relationship is shared.
In which way? Do you mean individual salaries or?
Well, I mean, no. If what you brought to the table in the marriage is yours, I agree. And what she brought to the table is hers, and that should never be disputed. But what was done during the marriage, investments and things like that the both of you were involved in, I think that stuff should be shared equally as well.
Okay. I see what you mean. It just gets complicated, right, when some things can't be, what's the word for it? You can't convert it into cash right away. They're not like liquid assets, let's say. When one person keeps the house and one person takes this and it's not my, I don't know too much about the legal stuff when it comes to this, but these things can still get complicated. So I think what you got to do is when you go into a situation and you're trying to take a relationship seriously, you say, in case of something happening, who gets what? Let's actually write our own contract and stick to it, and then that's it. You know, your savings are your savings, mine are mine, and
If you both put in money for the down payment on the house, then whatever equity comes out of the house would be, I would think, would be equally shared.
Right.
You know, not one person. But if you both pay into the house, who gets the house during the split?
Well, yeah, I would say it would be, you could do one of two things. Either you would sell the house and the equity that was made from the sale of the house would get split, or if one person wants to keep the house other than the other, then that person would, you'd calculate what the equity is in the house, and that person would then owe that person that share.
Yeah, that's good. That's good if you've got two people that are actually going to stick to it, but a lot of people...
They
won't stick to that crap. Maybe Lisa's not that case, but you don't know. Like, someone could screw you over, it's really sad, but... You know, that's all quite ideal, you know, which...
Well, I agree with you.
It's
just scary to me, like, the amount of avarice that people aren't even, aware of, the fact that people are nice to each other and pleasant, and then when a will comes into the picture or a divorce, then the money just makes people power hungry and just, not even human anymore, just treating each other like nothing. It's terrifying to me.
Well, and another problem, you're talking about, we need to write a contract in advance, like some prenuptial agreement. There's several cases where judges have thrown those out based on one partner coming up and saying, oh my gosh, this prenup's invalid because I was in a state of duress when I signed it, I was coerced into signing it, I was threatened into signing it. And that's all a judge needs to hear to say, because honestly, the judge has authority over what's going to happen. So yeah, you can say all you want. We signed a paper, we agreed to it. A judge can override that and say, you know what, I don't care. I'm throwing that document out and I'm deciding where your stuff goes. So honestly, if you want to entrust your assets to a total stranger behind a bench, by all means, that just does not sound wise to me. It doesn't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with that.
I do too.
Mm-hmm. And you hear a lot of situations. I mean, honestly, it's complicated when it comes to divorce between just two people, but you throw kids in and it's like...
Oh God!
That's where it really gets nasty.
Why
part of me, like, I know, Immortal, you've already made your decision when it comes to children that you choose.
I know. I won't preach on it anymore.
No, it's fine. I wasn't saying anything about it, but I'm just saying, like, myself, I go back and forth all the time in my mind because I do think it can be a very beautiful thing, but at the same time, it can completely destroy the relationship in some ways. It can put so much strain. It can mess up the kids horribly, and I'm not saying this is what always happens, but when kids into the picture, sometimes it can get very messy, so.
Oh, man, what I miss.
We're talking about children.
Children. So
oh, what I miss about children, because I love talking about children.
You wouldn't like this conversation. We were talking about divorce and, the complications that children bring to it. Sorry.
He's like,
well, I have a kind of a tragic story. It's a little family-ish, so I don't know if I want to share it because it might involve. I'll attempt to share without violating other people's privacy. How would I do that? Okay, I know someone that had kids, lost kids, and somebody else raised the kids, and there's no way that I can tell this story without violating other people's privacy. Oh my God, I am so sorry. I should have thought of that before I opened my big fat mouth. My bad.
Having damn, kids is hard. As well.
Yeah, it is.
Crap.
Yeah. No, having kids is hard, and it's always nice when you have bigger extended families that can take the kids and take care of them.
Yeah. Yep. If you got a little isolated, socially awkward family with that doesn't know any of the extended family, and they're all neurotic, and then they become agoraphobic. Anyway, I'm just going to talk about my own fucked up first two decades, but yeah. That does help, doesn't it? Having fucking, you know, support of grandparents or whatever, if they're not like, if they get on with you well.
It is.
Or, you know, whether you're the parent or the child or whatever, it's all linked together.
Well, I think having someone there that A, is fiscally responsible, that can put you through university so you can get your degree, is very, and say, you know, give you the love and support, is very important and vital. And even if a kid gets through a terrible situation, having that support and that financial backing, that person can end up being a really fantastic human being. I think so, as long as there's like some support there, that's totally, so very, very important.
I know, but some people, it's like they just get totally forgotten and shit, but...
Yeah, and that's really, really sad, so...
Yeah.
So are we saying that people who don't know anyone, who doesn't have extended families, shouldn't have kids because those kids are totally screwed?
Of course not, but it's one factor. It's just one factor. There's a lot of factors, you know, and how someone's likely to turn out and everything, of course.
But, so should people stay together because of kids or not?
They should stay together because they made a vow with each other. Because they made the vow to one another. Kids weren't there. So they need to remember, like, you know, if you exchange those vows and you say for better or worse, you better mean that before you just arbitrarily say that without, you know, you don't just irresponsibly tell someone that. Like, for better or worse, for richer or poor, until death, I am there by your side. You don't just say that because, oh, it feels good. I mean, yeah, kids or not, you stay with somebody because you promised them that you would. I mean, period. Let your yes mean yes and your no mean no. I mean,
yeah, of course.
But if it goes, you know, you shouldn't be glib about that shit. Absolutely, you're right about that, like, completely. But, you know, like, not everyone is. Some people aren't glib. They really mean it, and then it really genuinely surprises them, like, that maybe they resent the person, maybe they can't stand it, you know? Like, so at that point, you shouldn't just stay because of the vows, you know?
How about this? You marry a person, you made a vow to them, they get brain damaged and become a totally different person. Do you still love that person even though their brain, their soul is a totally different brain and soul?
I mean, that's why don't people consider how bad it can get? Like, isn't that what that means, for better or worse? You don't why aren't you considering the worst that can possibly happen?
When you say for worse,
you really need to consider the absolute fucking worst that it can go. Like, how bad can this person get? If you're not thinking about that, you don't need to be saying those words, period.
Well,
okay. I can see that. But shouldn't there be some caveats that you don't need to discuss? Or is there always that discussion? That's why people need to talk. I'm just actually bouncing
on. I think what immortal means, like, is the specific things they do in marriage ceremonies, which literally they do say, you know, better, worse, all that crap, like, and I think that's part of what's not good about marriage. You say this crap, and it is bullshit, you know, for most people. There's certain people where they do mean it, but that's part of it why I wouldn't do it. It's because, you know, you're saying all this shit that's just not true. Like, if they have brain damage or whatever, ugh, there's so much shit, you know, and...
Yeah, I like, think...
Yeah. I think yeah, he's I think talking about marriage specifically there, the ceremony and the things you say.
I mean, I'm just it's about those words, you know. It's my problem is just don't make promises you can't keep or you know you have no intention of keeping. Like, what's the point in that? What's the point in just in saying, yeah, I promise to do this? Like, if you know you can't do it, don't make the promise in the first place. That's not that difficult. Just yeah, say, well, yeah, like, you know that. What? Like, well, I'll be here with you as long as my needs are being met. But the moment my needs aren't being met anymore, I'm sorry. I'll be honest with you. I'm going to cut loose and leave. I mean, why can't people just have this honest conversation? Like, really, we're together because I enjoy your company. But the moment I no longer enjoy your company, I'm hitting the road. So why can't people just make that clear from the start and not lie about it?
Why don't people think about these things?
Yeah. I agree with you in that instance. I will say that I think it's somewhat hard to know what your destiny is going to be at 20 or 23 and what your life is going to look like at 40. The other thing, the reason I say that is, you know, my bipolar, you know, I mean, I literally destroyed my ex-wife's life. I mean, I made it a living hell. And it wasn't fair for me to keep her in that relationship. She wasn't happy. And, you know, I did some awful things, you know, to her. And, you know, even though we said for better or for worst, I mean, for better was, you know, to let her get out and live a life.
That's very open. Thank you for, you know, admitting that. I've made some horrific mistakes in my life, and yeah, it's hard. Thank you for sharing that.
Sure.
And I think you're right. I think once you come to the realization that it's time to set someone free, you do so, even though you made these commitments. What do you think about that, Immortal?
Well, you don't need to set someone free. They are free. If they don't want to be with you anymore, they will leave. And unfortunately, I think people figure that out the wrong fucking way when they're delusional, and they think, this person will never leave me no matter what. And then
isn't those two contradictory? Like you say, for better and for worse, you made that commitment, and then you're saying you can still be free. Like, how do those two ideas mesh with you? I'm just curious.
No, I'm saying you're one or the other. There are people who genuinely will be fiercely loyal to the point that I will stay with the person no matter how good or bad that they are until I'm dead. There are people that desire that, and they know they can do it because, like I said, they've considered, all right, what's the worst that can happen in this instance? You know, what's the worst? He cheats on me. He's abusive. Like you said, he has brain damage. Like, can I love a person through all of those, the shittiest things? And if they sit down and they say, I can, I know I can do that, then that lifestyle is for them, okay? But there are other people that just, they know they can't handle that. And so in that sense, they're just going to walk away whenever the hell they want because they're like, all right, well, I'm no longer investing in this relationship. What I'm saying is that you don't possess a person, okay? If they are free in the sense that they, you know, like you're saying, like, I need to let them go. You don't need to let them go. If they want to leave you, they're going to.
But if they made the commitment,
I don't in the least case say that I owned my ex-wife at all. She was definitely a free spirit. I will say that she stuck with me through thick or thin, in some of the best and the worst of times, and things weren't getting any better for me with my bipolar. And I just didn't feel it was right that she continue on in this relationship and suffer any longer. So I was not saying that in any way of it, like I owned her as a possession. She was very much her own person.
Yeah,
no, I wasn't implying that, but I mean, you know, you don't. I'm just saying the responsibility is on the other person, where it's just like, you know, I needed to let them go, and it's like, no, they were free to walk away at any time. So if someone's just in a shitty situation, it's like, it's your fault. No, they're there because they want to be, and then they leave because they want to be. That's on them. So, you know, I'm saying don't you know, don't take away the responsibility of the other person for saying, well, why the hell did you stick around? You know, they stuck around because they wanted to, and they left because they wanted to. That's on them. So, you know,
even if they, yeah, but that's
so, what
happened? I hate that it ended for you, but who initiated it? Was it you or her?
I did.
Okay, now, how did she feel? Did she say, like, okay, I've kind of, you know, I've, was it mutual? Was she like, okay, yeah, this is the best, or what? Or did she not agree with you ending it?
She was upset that it ended.
So was she really suffering in this arrangement, or is that just something you thought she was experiencing?
She was not. All right. She didn't want kids. I did. You know, and that was kind of a mutual struggle between us. She wanted to go to school. And could finish her higher education, and I certainly in my bipolar manic spending kept us so severely in debt that she could not go to school, and it's just a couple of things that went on. Was she comfortable in the relationship? I think she was. Had a lot of anxiety in the relationship, and that she was not being able to fulfill some of the things that she wanted to fulfill, and didn't see in the future that she was going to be able to. I think she was upset in the beginning. I think once we went to counseling and talked it out with a therapist, a marriage counselor, I think she was more comfortable with it, and we did part very amicably.
Okay. Well, did she know these things about you before?
No. I will tell you that I had bipolar since the age of 10.
Did she know this about you when she told you that she loved you? So did she know that was a part of what she was getting into with you?
No. No. She did not know the ride we were going to take. No, she did not. We were married very, very early.
Yeah, Immortal, like, she, like, I don't mean to take your...
No, go ahead.
Oh, thank you. She made a commitment. She took her vows. Now, is she obligated, even whether she wants to or not, is she obligated to stay no matter what? Even though he is saying, you are free to go. I understand, and I'm doing the right thing. Is she obligated to stay in your worldview, Immortal? To stay, is she obligated, or is she free to leave, even though she made the commitment?
Okay. All right. For me, this may sound really harsh, even though like this is why I'm not going to marry, because I'm a firm believer in these vows. So I'm like, I know that's not something that I would do, because I know how bad it can get, and I'm not willing to go through certain things with a woman if certain bad things happen. I know that about myself, so I'm not going to say those words and lie. My only thing is, if someone made that promise to go through that, okay, then I would never say if someone's in an abusive situation to stay there. I would say you need to flee the abusive situation or the abusive person and separate yourself from that. But if she made that vow, then I would say, like, look, you can be separated and you need to get away from the abuse. But look, if you know, you made a vow to that person, so you're still with that person. If you need to get away for a while and escape the abuse, do that. But in my view, if you made a promise to a person, you know, till death, then that's what you got. That's what you're. Yeah, that's what you're stuck with.
I respect the integrity of your words and.
No, I mean, I know that sounds. I know that sounds fucking terrible, but that's just.
No, it sounds like.
No, it doesn't sound bad. No, I respect that.
I don't know. I'm just saying, if you need to separate it. But if you made a vow to that person for life, you're stuck with that person for life. I'm sorry. That's just. How I view it. That's why I'm not going to do it. I don't want to be stuck with some person for life. I don't want that.
Yeah, no, but I'm having I'm seeing like a, like you're saying you're stuck with the, like, not you, but the person who makes the vow is stuck, but you're also saying that they have the right to leave an abusive relationship. There's
No, they don't. I mean, look, I'm not delusional. That's why I'm saying people make those vows and then break them all the time. I'm just saying if the vow meant anything, then that's what I think should happen. Like, if you make a promise, do it. I mean, what's the deal? Like, if you know you can't do it, don't say it. Maybe I'm a simpleton, I'm sure, in the way I view it. It's just like, don't fucking do it. If you know you're not going to follow through with something, don't look a person square in the eye and say, I am going to be this for you. Just don't do it. That's my simplification, but that's it.
Yeah, I value that.
Yeah, I
resent that too. I resent it when people, you know, like, aren't as committed as they say they are or something like that. Yeah, I hate that shit. Like, I felt very let down as a kid and that by family and just society, and I kind of was, and I'm not going to it right now. But, like, immortal, like, you sound like a man of your word, yeah? And most people in this, probably everyone here are like that. But, like, just, you know, most people, they do the marriage thing, and there's, like, an unspoken get out. You know, they don't talk to it, you know, talk about it with each other so much. Most people, like, you know, oh, well, even though we said all this crap, we could break up, but really deep down they know it, and they know the other half knows it, so, like, you know, they know they're just kind of buying into the whole wedding vows thing, even though they don't mean it, but they don't say so, and I resent that too. I'm kind of like, I'm not disagreeing with you as such, I really hate it, but it's like, but they kind of, they don't mean everything they say, you know, like, that's just, you know, you're kind of getting hung up on something which is understandable because people are just not doing what they're saying, you know, but it's just like an unwritten law, like, or unspoken thing, you know, that they don't, most people don't really mean it, you know?
Yeah, so believe what I say, but don't believe what I say?
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't like it either, but it's just the way it usually is, you know? Like, if they change the what a wedding is to something that's more ambiguous or just cuts out some of those, like, absolute things, then a lot of people would probably be more comfortable with it. A lot, you know.
Well, then what makes that so much more special than just being boyfriend girlfriend? Get what I'm saying? Because isn't that what a boyfriend girlfriend is? We're together as long as it's convenient.
Yeah.
Like, then what makes marriage any different? I mean, like, okay, we're still together as long as it's convenient for us, but we're just having a party. We're changing what we call each other.
That's the thing. What's the point? It's not. People go on like it is, but it's not. Like, most people go on like it is more a way bigger deal, but it's not, apart from financial things and such. You know, like, I think you'd like, I can understand your frustration. I understand why you ask that question like that. That's because most people go on like it is such a big deal, but it's not. Like, yeah.
Sorry, I just want to interject. I have a question for Steven here, which is related to the whole marriage thing, but also ties in mental health because Zane's not able to speak, so I'm going to ask it for him. He wants to know if you had any treatment, Steven, for your bipolar disorder, and I'm also wondering how that affected your second marriage and, you know, how that transpired. Yeah.
I did not get treated for my bipolar. I didn't even realize I was bipolar until I was 42 years old and tried to jump off a building.
Oh, my God.
And that's when I finally got sent to a hospital and finally got diagnosed with bipolar. And it was probably... That was probably 16 years into my current marriage with my first wife, and I think probably a lot of the therapy and the psychiatric visits that I went through over those 3 or 4 years, I think probably brought forth a lot of those feelings that, man, I look at what I've done over the history of this marriage and you know, I think that's when that realization finally hit in, and one day it was like, this is not good. I don't feel happy with what I have done.
That's good that you were able to come to that realization. Like, honestly, this is something that I've believed for a long time. I think if you know, like, I don't know if this is your case, Stephen, but if you know there's mental illness in your family, it's important to look into that, to ask the questions, even if it's embarrassing to you, because, I mean, there's still a huge stigma with mental illness, but ask your parents, ask your relatives, have they dealt with it, if you feel like you might be not feeling like yourself, let's say, and to be very introspective and to work on yourself, because I think the more you work on yourself, the more you're going to attract people that are like you, and then that you have a bigger chance of, you know, attracting people. Because the funny thing is, when I met my fiance, I wasn't acting like myself. I was depressed and I was at my lowest point and I was in denial. But during our relationship, I every time.
Yeah.
I was going on a monologue and it's like.
Well, let me throw this into the mix.
Yeah.
My father went to Georgetown University and Harvard to become a physician and ended up as a psychiatrist. Very well known on the East Coast. Mm. Never picked up on my bipolar my whole life. You know, I lived at home till I was 18, 19 years old. I was at a suicidal point and had a gun downstairs in my closet and was really trying to pull the trigger on it. And I went up and told my father, and he basically took the gun away from me and told me to go back to bed. Physicians do not treat family very well. They just don't know how to separate that from family. And I've seen this in countless, knowing a lot of physicians' families and their kids growing up. I know that this occurs very, very commonly, that they just don't know how to treat their family.
It's too close to like make out any definition of what they're seeing, so to speak.
Yeah, very, very true. Yeah.
That's a good point. I'd never really thought of it because I don't have too much of that in my family. But that's an interesting perspective.
Yeah, but once I got diagnosed and then knew that I started to have to ask questions of my mom and dad, there was quite a bit of history of schizophrenia and depression on both sides of my family, which I had never known.
Right. It's hard to uncover these things because I hate the stigma. I feel like we have come such a long way in the past 10 years, I'm going to say. We're not, it's not considered an illness to a lot of people. They just say, get over it. How many people still say when you hear you have depression, just smile more, try and get over it, and it's not seen as an actual problem. If someone has something really wrong with them and they have to, you know, they need a medical note for school or something, it's a lot harder to fix your school record based on mental illness, which I've had to do, and it's been very complicated. You have to go through a psychologist, and they have to write you up a paper, and then they have to really make sure that that's true, and it's like, not where if you have a physical ailment, people are like, oh, okay, that's why you couldn't take this exam or something, right? So,
yep.
Just
so true.
Tragic.
Yep.
Yeah, maybe they call your names behind your back at work as well.
Maybe. Blue Lou.
Don't say that. Never say
sorry,
that.
Sorry. It's
no, it's okay. I don't mind it to my face. Well, at least then I can, like, say something back. But, yeah. But, yeah, you know, you were saying you were about 40 when you were diagnosed, yeah? Like,
yeah.
That's interesting. And then I guess you could, like, look at your own issues and, like, and then probably from that treatment or understanding or something, that probably enabled you to, like, be better to your wife or, like, to consider her too.
Yeah, it did. I mean, it started to make sense of why I felt I could fly and want to jump off a building. It made sense about why I would go out and buy a $65,000 boat and landlock Denver. You know, it makes sense about why I would go out and buy, you know, a $75,000 automobile, you know, when clearly I couldn't afford the payments. You know, just that out of control manic behavior. You know, why I at a board meeting jumped up on the boardroom table and mooned the CFO and CNO of my company. Seemed like a perfect seemed like a perfectly good thing at the time.
Yeah.
Of course, it was the end of an illustrious career. But you know, I mean, just incredibly odd behaviors. But then they really started to all make sense.
Yeah, and Stephen, Zane just is wondering. I know you mentioned to me and Anya at the beginning. He's saying, has anyone ever been successful in drug treatment for bipolar? So if you don't mind just discussing what you've done with that a bit for him, that would be cool.
Yeah, I've been on medication since my diagnosis. I've gone through a lot of meds. I found that they tend to work for a while, and then they start to lose their effectiveness, so you've got to keep changing them up, and sometimes you even go back to ones you were doing 3 years ago, and they work again. So it's a process of, you know, finding the right combinations of antidepressants and antipsychotics and mood stabilizers, and then working with a good psychiatrist, a good psychiatrist who's good in pharmacology, and keeping up and track on those. For the most part, they help very well. Still have depressive episodes, still have manic episodes, but for the most part, they're a little less than not being on meds at all. Went through a lot of ECT when the meds finally stopped working for a period of time. Had about 40 ECTs. Don't know that I'd ever go back and do that again. It wrecked my brain.
What's an ECT?
Electroconvulsive therapy.
Is that like shock?
It is shock therapy, yeah.
They still do that?
Oh, they do it quite a bit. And, you know, from the old, what was the movie, The One Fly Over the Cuckoo's Nest, where they did the shock therapy and everybody kind of knows that. It's gotten a lot better over the years. You know, the technology has improved, the equipment has improved. But, yeah, they use it quite commonly for the treatment of severe depression. It worked for a while, but then I'd keep having to go back and get more treatments in. Just the sheer amount of ECT treatments that I had just really wrecked my short-term memory. Things now, I mean, my memory is good up to about 3 months, but after 3 months, things are very cloudy. I don't really remember things after that period of time, so...
That's a long-term memory thing, wouldn't that be?
My short-term memory is really good up to about 3 months, and then I start losing it at the long as things go on. My long-term memory, long-term memory, is still pretty much intact. I do have a lot of memories. Although I will say there are some gaps in my long-term memory that are very, very sketchy. But overall, I can remember my childhood and growing up and, you know, family and stuff like that.
So that's how desperate shit gets. People, like, they would do this when it was far more dangerous as well. And even lobotomy, like, lobotomy would be the next stage where they just take a chunk of your brain and you might end up, like, not being able to control your shitting and pissing and all that too. Mm-hmm. So... yeah, that's how desperate shit gets. So I was in a psychiatric hospital with people who did ECT and stuff, and they were really bad. I don't think you are your worst or even as bad as this one woman I'm thinking of, but she's like, she was ultra neurotic. I wouldn't be the least bit surprised if she's killed herself. I hate to say it anyway.
But, yeah.
Like, are you type 1 or type 2?
Type 1 with psychotic features.
Does that mean like delusional? You have episodes? Because I've got a friend who, like, when I first met him, like, he's got bipolar. When I first met him, he was talking about the mind prophecies all the time, and apparently he's been far worse than that as well. But like, he had this delusion, like, everything was linked to the mind prophecies, and It's weird. I don't know if he even believed in the 2012 thing. I think that was mind prophecies, but I don't know if he even believed in that at all. But he would go on mental about that crap. But
I have visual and auditory hallucinations, particularly if I stop taking my meds, which is an unfortunate part of being bipolar. You miss a few days and then I will start getting auditory hallucinations and visual hallucinations.
But that sounds like, well, I'm not saying that's not a big deal or something, but like that sounds like you know they're hallucinations.
Well, I guess the way I express that, some of it I do. I'm aware that, you know, the things that I'm seeing are not necessarily real. It doesn't change the fact that they are real when I'm viewing them. So it's kind of hard to describe. I mean, yes, they are, but, you know, what I'm seeing is affecting me and causing problems, but I also kind of know they're not real, but, boy, they're sure real when they happen.
Wait, so is it like you have delusional episodes, or is it like, you know, it's obviously it's real in your head, like everything, but like, are you actually delusional for a period of time? Like, is it like that? Because some people have those.
Yes, it is for a period of time.
That's so trippy. That must be, like, difficult to even think about, like, how you kind of, if your sanity slips for periods of time, like, that's, like, really trippy. Like, just, you know, to put it lightly.
It is, and you know, I'm very, very thankful and grateful that I have a wife who is a psychiatric nurse who is pretty keen on picking those kind of things up. She's keen on knowing when I'm starting to lose touch with reality, and, you know, I mean, she's quick to check the meds, and she's quick to get meds in me and stuff like that. She's been a great asset, but it still sometimes gets out of control.
I'm going to ask a question that sounds like I'm taking a piss. Have you seen A Beautiful Mind?
I have not.
Oh, you should watch it. Good film.
It's great. It's great.
I'm gonna write that down right now. Great, thanks.
I've kind of given away the twist. Anyway, no. I've now trivialized your whole life.
I'll forget what you said, so I gotta write it down.
Trivialized his whole life. That's a big statement. Yeah, nice one, Lewis.
Yeah.
Actually, a movie that I've been meaning to see is Silver Linings Playbook, because I heard it's about mental health, right? But
oh my god, that's such a damn good movie. You need to.
They just took it off Netflix. Like, they just.
What? Oh my god.
Yeah, I was like ready to watch it yesterday, and then I was like, I guess I'm going to watch some more Heroes.
Someone uploaded the whole movie to YouTube, and I, like, downloaded a copy of it. If I could send it to you, but it's so badass. Holy shit. Hey. I have no shame in admitting this. I saw that movie in theaters, oh my god, probably 7 times. I have no shame. I paid to see it that many times. Like, if I was on a weekend, I was like, I don't know what I want to do. I think I'm going to go watch that movie again. I was like, seriously? I couldn't get enough of it. Like, holy shit, when you see it, it's fucking amazing. Yeah.
Is it about depression or what exactly?
Oh my god, what is it? Like, Jennifer
you
Lawrence,
know by
when
you
see...
Know.
No, all right, listen. It's not... Oh, shit, what was it? Because, all right, the main character is... I think he is bipolar. Bradley Cooper's character is bipolar, and what happens is that... Wait, I want to spoil anything. I don't know if I want to. Holy shit, like, it's amazing. Like, his trigger for, like, a bipolar episode is a song. Like, he hears a song, and he goes fucking nuts.
Yeah.
And, and it's... I think it's, like, his wedding song, and it just so happens he, like, goes home to his house and, like, finds his... wife in the shower having sex with another guy while that song is playing, and so that's what makes him fucking crazy, because he thinks of that song and he sees that going on, and so he loses his shit every time he hears that song. Like, he goes in the therapist's office and that song starts playing over the speaker. Oh, yeah. He's like, is that song really playing? And the poor girl at the front desk is like, yeah, and he's just like, He's like, that song is killing me. Could you please turn it off?
Oh, no. Speaking of marriage. Yeah.
Yeah, but he goes and finally he meets a psychiatrist and he's like, I see that song is still a trigger for you. And he's like, yeah, doc, you got that right. Still a trigger.
Yeah.
I need to see that movie. It's so bad. This is amazing. This is like my Netflix, part of my Netflix experience. Every time I see a movie, I'm like, I've been meaning to watch that, and I'll look a week later and it's taken down off Netflix. I'm like, come on.
Well, you know what's amazing is that, oh my god, like these are the most dysfunctional characters you've ever seen put on screen.
Yeah.
They do the most fucked up shit to each other, and yet they still end up together. So it's just like, my god, like, shit. Like, he just says the worst shit to her for, like, no damn good reason. Like, she just goes and she goes and looks at him and says, I hate that you wore a football jersey to dinner because I hate football, so you can, like, fuck me if you turn the lights off, okay? and he's just like, he's like, how old are you? He's like, old enough to have a marriage and to not wind up in a mental hospital. And then he goes like, look, I'm sorry. He's like, I think you're really pretty and stuff, but I'm married, okay? Even though he's, like, separated from it, like, he's delusional. His wife has left him, but he still says that he's married.
Oh,
so he shows her his ring. He's like, I'm married, okay? And she's like, he's like, yeah. He's like, so am I. And she shows him his ring. He's like, no, no, you're not, because your husband's dead. And then, like, she just starts fucking sobbing. And he's like, oh my god, what? Why the fuck did I say that? And then she, like, slaps the shit out of him and walks away. And it's just like, damn.
I finally saw the movie Gone Girl, speaking of mental cases and things.
Oh, yeah, that woman is so far gone. Jesus.
It was a good movie, though.
It was, first.
And because the thing that kind of frustrates me is when, you know, somebody wants to make a point about a movie, but then they don't read the book, too, to get the full sense of it. That's just a little pet peeve of mine, because, like, you're going to get the information from the original work, you know what I mean? And then can kind of take it from there. But I think, honestly, the movie, they did a very good job of at least, you know, showcasing the most important parts so you get a pretty good, you know, idea of it. Because it's very hard to condense, like, you know, a few hundred pages of a book into some movie and make it, you know, all come together nicely. That's why so many people complain about Lord of the Rings or, like, the Harry Potter movies. Or I still don't know how they got The Hobbit into three movies from one book. But anyways, you know, like,
there's an interesting thing. I'm a big sci-fi nerd. I love sci-fi. And there was another gripe. Even though I love the movie personally, and maybe it's because I didn't read the original book, but a lot of people had a problem with 1980s Dune, original Dune, when they made that film. And I thought it was great, but a lot of people, there was so much apparently that was written in the book about the main character, Paul Atreides, where there's a lot of things that can only be written. You can't show it in a movie. Like, for instance, he does a lot of, like, thinking out loud in the book. You know, he articulates his thoughts out loud, and when he's speaking out loud in the story, that's where you really get to know what he's about. Like, when he ingests the like, oh my gosh, I think it's like the stomach bile of one of the worms of Arrakis. It's normally supposed to kill you, but he's the only man who can survive its toxic effects. And in the movie, you think, oh, he just survived it because he's special. But that's not what happened in the book. He actually had to use his mental discipline to control the reaction going on in his body.
Okay.
But in the movie, you didn't see that. You just see him, like, shake and shudder, and you think he's dying, and then he, like, wakes up and everything's okay. But in the book, you hear him, like, working out what he needs to do to, like, stay alive, because he's ingested this poison, in essence. And in the movie, you don't see that, but people who read the book are like, oh man, like, that's the one thing they didn't like. Is
it's like that with most, like, translations, though, because books are in effect longer than films. Because, like, consider, you don't, like, finish a whole novel or whatever in, like, 1.5 hours or 2 hours or whatever. So you can all, you know what I mean? There's always going to be more depth, you know?
You know, it's actually, if you know what I'd prefer, if they had access to the same effects budgets as movies, like, I think TV series would be so much more effective in telling a good story. I think the problem is because I love sci-fi and, like, superhero films, and so I'd love for them to make TV series out of those instead, so you could, like, the character gets more, you know, fleshed out better. But they just don't have the effects budgets to really convincingly put such a thing on screen as opposed to like a movie. So of course, whenever you're like, we have to condense a very long story into like 2 hours, yeah, you're gonna miss a lot. It's why I love the new series Daredevil. It's amazing because they go episode by episode and they don't miss a single thing of that character's story. And even though I like the director's cut of Daredevil, it was such a better movie than the theatrical. The show does it a lot better because the characters are completely fleshed out the way they need to be.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Like, but I thought, like, I've not watched these series like Game of Thrones or whatever, but like, aren't they like that? Like, really long films where they can just like flesh it out. And I know they're not from books. Well, I think they're not. Actually, they probably are from books. Fuck it. But
no, Game of Thrones is a book. Yeah, that show is based on a book.
Well, isn't that exactly the kind of thing? I mean, they're like critically acclaimed. You know, shit like that. And these series like Breaking Bad that I've not watched one episode of. Mm-hmm. Isn't that exactly what you're like asking for anyway?
Yeah, I would prefer that. Like TV series with the same effects that you get in a movie would be so much better because you can tell the whole story if it's a series, because then let's say if you run out of time, you just renew it for another season and you keep going. You know, like say it could be season one could be like, say, if it's Superman or something, you could really flesh out the rivalry between Superman and Lex Luthor the way it's meant to. And then like season two, you could say, all right, now it's Superman versus other Kryptonians or Superman versus Brainiac. Like, you wouldn't miss anything, but in a movie, you know, so many people are like, hey, tell this story, tell this story, tell this story. And when you try and cram all of it into 1-2 hour version, so much is missed. Unlike a TV series, you can tell everything.
Yeah, I get what you're saying. Like, there aren't many series like that. I guess even ones like these ones I mentioned, I don't know if even they have the kind of budget of a super long movie, because that's really hard. I mean, imagine the budget that goes into films like, I don't know, King Kong or something like that. Imagine that, like,
exactly,
a whole series, like that, like times whatever. Exactly. Like, that would be insane money.
Like, the TV show version of that movie. Like, because what really made that movie so captivating was Andy Serkis and the motion capture, the technology that they used to allow him to play the ape, right? That's what made it believable, is you're like, shit, this looks like an actual gigantic ape on screen, right? And you need that. You need King Kong to have that persona for you to be like, oh my gosh, like, you really sympathize with this gigantic monster, right? But if they turned it into a show, I think you'd lose the effect of that, because King Kong wouldn't look as good as he would in the movie, and that's why you're so invested in him. So if they had like a TV show budget, I don't think King Kong would look as good, or I don't think it would do it justice, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, I get you, but it depends on money, like a lot of things. But
yep, exactly.
I know what motion capture is, by the way. I know that geek reference. It's where they have the bubbles on them, you know what I mean?
And you have to have a good actor, and Andy Serkis is just fantastic. Fantastic guy. I mean, he played Caesar in Planet of the Apes, both movies. I mean, he's really good at what he does.
Yeah, I don't even know who that is, but okay.
He played do you follow Lord of the Rings?
No.
Yeah.
Oh shit. Okay. All right. Well, he plays Gollum in Lord of the Rings. He was King Kong in King Kong. And he was Caesar in both Planet of the Apes films. He's really good, so you should see those movies, and you'll see what I'm talking about.
Being King Kong, does that mean being his voice and his motion capture, or just being his motion?
Well, no. Capture? King Kong doesn't speak. He has no voice. But,
I mean, but the noises and that. Like, I've not really seen the film, but I presume you don't speak in words and that. But being his actor just sounds like you're doing his movements. So
I actually think some sounds he did, because I know when he played Caesar, he actually did some of the ape sounds in that role. Now, I'm sure some of them were borrowed from, like, say, an actual gorilla in real life, but I think Andy Serkis actually did do some of the others, because there are noises that King Kong made that sounded more like human, and so I think that was him, but there are other instances where I'm sure they just recorded an actual gorilla sound into the movie.
That must be so awkward, being a voice actor sometimes, and the noises you have to make. I always thought of that. I'm like, you hear a noise, you're like, wow, someone did that. Like,
yeah. Yeah.
Hey, you know what? You know, I don't follow Gollum, right? But Gollum follows me, right? I've got these weird things like Precious on my YouTube video, like on two separate things. Yeah. Have you got those?
Yeah, somebody wrote to me too. They're like, I want to be your Precious gem or something.
What, Gollum, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a relief. Well, hopefully that's a relief for you as well, because I don't think they're stalking both of us in both.
Bet it's Hugh Laurie. I bet you it's Hugh Laurie in one of his multiple accounts.
Maybe.
I think so.
That would be funny, yeah.
I bet. Yeah, because he wrote something like, I want to be your Precious gem. I'm like, and it's like Gollum. I'm like, what? The funny thing is I don't even like think about these things, you know, now that you mention it, but I get so many random like comments and names and things on my videos. I'm like, I'm just not going to ask anymore. I'm just going to accept. And I'm going to go on. Like, that's my YouTube channel now, so...
Yeah.
Like, I have people going to my channel like, I hate you, you're horrible, and then the next time they're like, you're amazing, and I'm like, okay, I'm just gonna not comment back to you because you're scaring me, so.
Yeah, I know it's one person kind of a bit flip-floppy like that. It just looks kind of bizarre, but there you go.
Oh, what's that girl's name that comments on your it's really awful, awful comments. I can't remember her name. Alexandria Gerbil, whatever.
Die, I don't like you, or something like that. It's like, damn, that's lame.
Yeah, and then she wrote to me, oh, you look nice today. I'm like, okay, I'm just not going to comment back to you.
What, is that a troll?
She's looking for a rise out of you, so don't give it to her.
I think some people troll because they find it amusing. Some people troll to try and cover up their actual insanity. So there's like, there's different kinds of trolls, do you know what I mean? Like, being a troll makes a good cover for being actually legitimately insane, right? So it's like, oh, they're just a troll. I'm like, actually, they're just insane and they're masquerading as a troll, but you know.
That sounds a bit crazy itself.
It's like the case with bullies, right? You know, it's a complete facade to cover up for the fact that they're probably the weakest person out there. But it's a fraudulent face they put on to cover for the fact that they don't want people to know. They don't want people to know how scared they are, how vulnerable they feel, and so they just have to attack. So
I don't think all bullies like that. I think some are just sociopathic. But I think a lot are like that.
One of the bullies, I'll never forget, like someone who used to bully me. It's funny, when I met him in later grades, we actually ended up getting along. But the truth eventually came out that why he was that way is he would go home and his dad beat the shit out of him. And so he, you know, because he felt so helpless at home, he needed to feel, you know, he needed to do something to feel like he was in charge of something or somebody. And so that's why he did the shit that he did. He needed to feel powerful sometime. And so that's why he preyed on people.
That's very common. That's very common, like physical abuse turning into bullies. But like, I think it's very common, like, that they're hiding something when it's like, when it's trolly type bullies. Like, I mean, you know, do you know what I mean? People that like try to hurt your feelings in childish kind of ways or whatever. That's usually they're just like, just kind of weak and shit. But some people really are just sociopaths and just really genuinely don't give a shit. You know, there's that element too.
Well, I think there's an origin for everything, whether it's environmental or it's genetic. You know, there's this whole field of epigenetics where you can have a combination of events, or it can be just environmental triggers. But there's a reason for everything. I really do believe in kind of cause and effect, and you know, I don't believe in some spirituality and some things that you go, wow, that was really random, but randomness does occur in the universe, and that's a normal thing. I actually read a lot about that kind of stuff, but there's always a start to everything and a reason for why things happen a certain way. So
have you looked into determinism as a concept?
No, but that would be something very interesting to read on. Can you recommend anything?
Ooh, can I? Free will. Probably the most accessible thing would be this like talk called Free Will by Sam Harris.
Right. Like,
it's so profound. Like he says, for example, and I do harp on about this topic too much, it's kind of weird. But he says, like, think of a city, any city, and what comes into your head, and then afterwards it's like, okay, why did that come into your head? And you know, people don't know. No one knows. And there might be some reason, like maybe maybe earlier in that day they saw something on the TV about Paris or something, I don't know. Or someone mentioned it on the bus, they overheard a conversation talking about fucking Cairo or something, but
right.
Like there's like subconscious, there's just so many reasons. Like he also, I'm going off on a weird tangent here, but he also mentions this guy who went on a shooting spree and left a net, like a note saying, when I die, which is imminent, obviously, like, examine my brain. And they did it, and they found, like, that he had a massive tumor. And it's like, if they would have never found that, if he wouldn't have left that note, they wouldn't have examined it. And everyone would be like, yo, this guy's so fucking evil and whatnot. But because he's, you know, he happens to have a tumor, they treat it completely differently. When really it's just like, it's all just brains doing what brains do, you know what I mean? Whether they're a sociopath or they've got a tumor or what. I hope we don't think this is just a weird tangent. But
Well, if I could add to that tangent, I have a very strong belief that this is all a big test of our reaction, or a test of my reaction. And coincidental things which happen that are very, like, almost can never happen, like it's totally without, you know, not within the realm of possibility, I'm sitting there going, well, that's a test of my reaction, because there's no way that this could be happening without it, without there being some kind of universal, I don't know, scientist, mad scientist going, we're going to have this happen to Doug, and we're going to test his reactions.
Wait, are you saying it's a test?
Think about this.
What are you saying, it's a test to not start thinking it's some like deity or something, or?
No, just the test. Well, yeah, it could be that, like, the reaction could be there's a deity, or the reaction could be the universe is out to get me, or the reaction could be, hey, everyone loves me. Like, just a test of my reaction to see how my brain reacts to certain stimuli.
Yeah, like egocentricity, right? Like, this is a kind of flaw of people's brains. Like, it's natural to have more egocentricity, like, more sense of it than you really, like, the natural importance you have, like, you know what I mean, on the scale of the universe or whatever, and society. But some people have it a lot where they get really paranoid and they feel, and they get really superstitious, like, and it's a weakness. So I think I get what you mean there.
Yeah, but it's not, because it's not just to me. It could be to everybody, or it could be no one else exists except me, or it could be everyone else exists except me, and I'm just a little matrix program. Like, it doesn't have to be centric to me as it involves other people. Like, you leave all the other people out of it, and how it affects other people, because it might not be them, it might be them, you never know. Like, I don't want you to come away with believing that it is an egocentric type thing that I'm thinking.
Okay, maybe I'm projecting. That's probably more my problem. I don't know.
But yeah, no. But I've been getting out. I'm trying to think of prime examples. Actually, I have a prime example that I said to someone. I'll say it here. Why not? Okay, does anyone know the game roulette?
Yes.
Spinning thing, ball.
This one, ball, the Coutier,
yeah,
all that. If nobody knows the game roulette, then there's no point.
Russian in roulette? Yeah, I know that game.
You know that game, okay.
Sorry.
So, I was playing, and every time I play lately, everything comes in three. Like, the number eight will come once, and then it'll come twice, and then I'll bet big on eight, and then after four or five spins, it'll come a third time. And I'm kind of big in Wicca, not big, or kind of been studying Wicca, and three is a significant number in Wicca. And it happened just a few days ago. I was like, okay, well, eight came twice. I'm going to bet you know, normal, and I didn't bet the 8 big, which is something I usually do, and it came, and I was like, okay, well, I'm going to bet big on this number, and if it comes, it's the goddess telling me of her existence. And that number came, and I won quite a bit of money. And obviously, that has my brain thinking, obviously, the goddess exists. Now, that type of reaction, is that absolutely delusional, or is that a cause and effect type of...
I don't know. Zane seems to think that it's coincidence.
I don't believe in Wicca. I've got a friend. I think it's the same thing. Like, that's witchcraft, right? He believes in witchcraft. Honestly, I think you're probably more logical than he is. Like, he's not a stupid guy, but you can get so superstitious and stuff. I don't believe in that stuff. Like I consider gods and stuff like that, like, heavily linked with superstition and just being told that shit when you're young. So you just, like, you associate everything with it. It's like God centricity, like you see patterns that involve it when they don't really exist, you know. So
actually, yeah. I do know, because I was born into Roman Catholicism. I'm a Catholic, of course, or at least I was until I started watching a lot of atheist videos. But yeah, everything that I did in the past would be measured against how God would do it, and I was an awful, horrible, terrible person, right? And then atheism, I started watching a lot of atheists, realizing that there is no God, and I'm a fool to judge myself from that absolutely impossible yardstick. So I looked into Wicca, and I'm finding Wicca to be a very helpful tool to get rid of my Catholicism. If that makes sense.
Yeah, it might be better for your mental health. So I still don't believe in it, though.
Yeah, like, I have an absolute belief in God, and I shouldn't, because God doesn't exist. And I've been fighting that for quite a few years now, that I sit there going, hey, this is going to piss God off. Wait a minute. No, it's not. Because there is no God. What the hell are you thinking, Doug?
And it's built in.
Yeah. So when this happens, and it's very coincidental, I'm thinking to myself, okay, well, this proves that the goddess exists, but no, it doesn't. And if this set of events can happen, obviously all those things that I thought was God way back when, obviously, that's probably not true either.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of like comparing God to something else that's similarly not true.
Well, God to the
goddess,
and neither of them exists, even though a set of events happened that was highly improbable, doesn't mean that the goddess exists, right?
Yeah. Like, super improbable things happen all the time. Like, they just do. Like, you got 7 billion people, for example, all dreaming for about 3 hours a night or two or something. Like, look it up. And, and people are surprised when shit happens in real life that happens in their dreams. And they're like, oh, it must be supernatural. You know, like, it'd be insane if shit didn't happen that was exactly the same as some people's dreams the night before. Like, that's a random example, but
deja vu example, that hey, I dreamed this, it happened, therefore God, or therefore the supernatural.
Yeah, it's just it's shit in people's brains, and some people can't conceive, they literally can't even contemplate the idea of no God, for example. If you get someone early enough and drill it into them, that's very likely how they'll turn out, you know?
Yeah, like, I still have the delusional God belief, but I know that it's not true. But I still have it, and it's very, very... I curse everyone who's religious that inflicts this upon children, anyone under the age of 18. I really do. Just because it adversely affected me so horribly and has me believing crap that's just not true.
Yeah, sounds like you got cognitive dissonance now. That sounds really uncomfortable. Also, sounds like the you know, Catholicism stuff made you, you know, feel shame and everything, which is very closely linked with SA. So
it's a religion of shame and control.
Yeah. So yeah. Anyway, this is. I feel like we're just dominating the conversation with this. Religion talk.
Y'all want something cool? This is something I was thinking about writing a short story about, but you know what I think the greatest superpower might be that anyone could have?
Absolute power over all of everything. Go on.
Okay. Well, something you could actually write a story around, because it's not absolute, but think of it this way. What if you had the power to do anything you imagined?
That is absolutely.
Now, here's the kicker. Here's the kicker, all right? This is why this is not as all-powerful as you may think. So the problem is, what have we suffered from for so many years growing up or through all our lives? What have we been told so many times? What we can't do. This is what you can't do. This is what is not. This is what's possible. This is what's impossible, right? So, and we're also so used to what our bodily limitations are. And we've been used to that for so many years. So let's say, could you, even if, let's say you wanted to imagine, you know, jumping the length of the Grand Canyon, okay? I don't think you'd be able to, because for so many years, you're used to your bodily limitations of, this is how high I jump, this is how long I jump. So how do you override that? You get what I'm saying? I thought, let's say if you wanted to imagine flying, how can you imagine yourself flying if you've never felt yourself leave the ground? How can you imagine yourself doing that unless you've experienced it? So I considered, if that was my character, you know, he could say, first of all, he imagined having like as much money as possible, because that's easy to imagine. So he has to have all this money in order to say, so let's say he fills his account with money, but it's for one purpose. He goes, you know what, I want to fly, but I need to know what it feels like to be weightless. So I would think you'd be able to fly, but only if you, say, went on a zero-G plane and actually were able to experience what your body feels like weightless. Then I think you could imagine yourself being able to fly, right? But isn't that interesting? So let's say my thing is, even if you had the power to imagine anything, would we really be as powerful as we think? Because for so much of our lives, we've been so conditioned to believe that there's so much we can't do. And so for anything to manifest, you have to have absolute belief that, you know, what you want will happen. But I would think the minute you doubt that, your power wouldn't work. You get what I'm saying?
Wow, that's trippy. Yeah, I get what you're saying.
It'd be a good
part. That kids, that listening, all the kids, is why you should snort cocaine just once. Because it'll expand your blood.
Guys, on that note, I think we should go into the after party now. What do you guys think?
I've never done that, by the way, kids.
Well, I thought you meant the after party. Alright. So guys, what we'll do is we'll go off air, but we'll continue talking, and anyone that wants to join, the link to join is on Google+ and on the description bar in YouTube. So come join us, alright? So bye, live viewers. Thanks for watching.